pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. How is everyone today? A lot of smiling faces. Good, Matt. All right, somebody caught that. All right. Feel better now. Okay, roll call, please. Your time to shine.
Commissioner Jewell.
Here.
Commissioner Boyle.
Here.
Commissioner Grimm.
Here.
Commissioner McDonald.
Here.
Commissioner Musson.
Present.
Commissioner Nelson.
Here.
And Chair Commissioner Yugovich.
Present. Thank you. At this time, citizens will be allowed to address the board on items not on the agenda. Speakers will be limited to 5 minutes each. We've got a number of people here today that wish to speak, and we'll start with Mark Bogue. Morning.
Good morning. So my name is Mark Bolden. I grew up on the far west side of Duluth out in Gary. My wife is from Morgan Park. After college, went to work in the oil and gas industry, lived all over the world, and moved back to Duluth in 2009. My grandfather, John Bolden, immigrated to the United States to work in the underground mines in Ely. There, he married Frances Clune, my grandmother. My father, Edward Bolden, and his brother, John, were born in Ely. They moved to Gary on the far west side of Duluth to work in the new U.S. steel plant that stretched all the way from Morgan Park to New Duluth. My father and his three brothers both worked at the plant, retiring when the plant closed in the 1970s. Our community of Gary and New Duluth, it's two separate communities, is like Aurora and Hoyt Lakes. Our values are the same: family, community, work hard, create a better life for your children. We are the same. The Gary New Duluth recreation area was shut down by the city in 2009 due to budget shortfalls. In 2013, we, a group of people connected to the community, either we grew up there, we lived there, we had businesses there, we have a strong emotional attachment to our community, we established the G&D Development Alliance, a 501(c), to revitalize and transform the recreation area. We had numerous community meetings to determine what the community wanted and developed a vision and a plan to present to the city. This is a city park. As the G&D rec is a city park, we needed city permission to put our plan into action. The city approved our plan. In 2015, after our Memorial Day ceremony, the old shack was opened as a community center. We had completely transformed a skating shack into a true community center. Two soccer fields were built in 2016, an open-air pavilion with parking lot, paved safe sidewalks and lighting was completed in 2016. We built a dog park and that was completed in 2018. The community garden was completed in 2019, along with a multi-activity sport court. 2019 saw the start of the urban design streetscape skate park with work continuing in 2020 and 2019. All of this work, raising of the funds, developing the plans, organizing and coordinating the project, and operating the community center has been done by our nonprofit. We're all volunteers. To date, more than $2.5 million, which includes in-kind contributions, has been raised to bring the G&D rec to this stage, where it is functioning as the family center of our community, along with Stowe Elementary School, which is right adjacent to the G&D rec. The benefits of our project are that we are providing a place for people from 5 to 95. We are building pride and strengthening the social fabric of our community. We are now at the stage where the end is in sight. The skate park surface is ready for concrete. A small open air pavilion has been purchased and ready for installation, and a parking lot with sidewalks is to be constructed. It's estimated that we need $600,000 to complete our project. As we present this to you today, we would like your consideration to provide us some support. We believe, and we have seen, that the transformation of the G&D rec creates jobs, attracts people to our community for commerce, and it attracts people to live in our community, making our community stronger. We are getting young families moving to the community because of the G&D rec and its association with the elementary school there. So I get a lot of comments about talking too long, and I can certainly do that, which is why I wrote it down. Thank you so much for your attention and the opportunity to speak today. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Next is Gina Brescubli.
Close.
Okay, that'll work. Sorry about that.
Right. Italian name.
Yes.
Silent G.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, distinguished county board, Sheriff Littman, and audience members. My name is Gina Brascoli, and I live on the Iron Range. I feel that although there are pros and cons for the use of body-worn cameras, I feel the pros outweigh the cons. And I think BWCs, where the St. Louis County Sheriff's Department is concerned, are long, long overdue, but better late than never. In my opinion, anyone who has ever been lied to, lied about, beat up, marginalized, or harassed by law enforcement would feel at least partially vindicated by the approval of BWCs for the deputies of St. Louis County. Anyone ever falsely accused of a crime or misquoted in a police report would possibly also feel some vindication. Anyone who has had loved ones shot by the St. Louis County Sheriff's Department would most likely want to see the implementation of BWCs for the deputies. I would like to read a thank you in bold print that was placed in the obituary section of the Mesabi Tribune in the Sunday, December 5th, 2021 edition. Thank you. December 5th, 2020, we lost our young 19-year-old grandson, Esteban Eliaf. A belated thank you to all who so kindly responded. We live with the sad memory of 5 bullet holes in his thin back and police dog bites on his legs. Great-grandpa Dominic and great-grandma Josie. Please don't make BWCs about taxpayer dollars when voting to authorize the purchase of body-worn cameras. According to NPR News, state troopers, Department of Natural Resources conservation officers, Capitol Security officers, BCA agents, and other state-level law enforcement will all be wearing BWCs very soon. In my opinion, it is time for the St. Louis County Sheriff's Department to wear them also. Thank you for your time and attention to this matter.
Thank you. Okay, next we have Nathan
Cloakley.
Come on down. How are you this morning?
I'm doing well. Thank you for
having me. My name is Nathan Glokely, and I'm the former principal of Stowe Elementary School out in Gary, and also a member of the Gary New Duluth Developmental Alliance. Well, I'm here today to advocate the same thing that Mark was here, but I have a little different spin on what is happening boots on the ground in that community. I believe leadership is about bringing people together. And over the last 8 years, I have seen a transformation in how the community supports the school. Pre-COVID, we actually had increased attendance in our kindergarten. We added a kindergarten section. And before, battling with Renshaw, with Proctor for enrollment, they saw something, and that was the revitalization efforts from our community to really show support for students on up through 95, as Mark mentioned. The benefits that we have seen have increased enrollment. During the pandemic, we kept our doors open at Stowe Elementary School. We went skiing, we utilized our 40 acres of outdoor trails, and have fortunately kept our scores when other scores were going down in other schools. We were able to maintain the lack of education, but we were outside still, kept kids in that educational and schooling mode. And so our project is grand. When you look at the budgets that we are faced with, this is an opportunity to finish a project that's been in the making a long time, but it has brought so many people together for the common good. Thank you.
Thank you. Next we have Gary
Bubalo.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Thank you. Thank you for having us here, allowing us to speak. I'm Gary Bubalo. I grew up in Gary, New Duluth. My grandfather, my father, I and my son all attended Stowe Elementary School at one point. And I'm part of the GND Development Alliance as well. Gary New Duluth. Gary New Duluth, you know, it's part of Duluth, but it has an identity all its own. When most people hear of Duluth, they think of Canal Park, Bayfront, London Road, UMD, Hartley Park, Congdon. Gary New Duluth, you know, that's way out there, isn't it? And you know, I admit Gary New Duluth is unique. It's like many small towns that are sprinkled across northern Minnesota and the Iron Range, even though it's a community within Duluth. It's a U.S. steel company town that had boom times in the 30s, 40s, 50s, and 60s, and suffered an economic downturn in the 70s and 80s, which changed the entire complexion of the community, which sounds familiar to a lot of you, I'm sure. Like many similar communities, they've struggled, we've struggled and suffered, but never quit. And now we're back on the upswing. Mark Bobin and I, we grew up there in the 50s and 60s and graduated from high school in 1972 from Morgan Park with illustrious alum Mark Rubin. In 2010, Mark had moved back to town after living all over the world, a new set of eyes. He said, hey, he gave me a call. He said, hey, you remember that Veterans Memorial we used to stand behind when we were police boys, stay out of the wind? I said, yeah, I remember it. He said, well, it's looking a little tired. Where do you think we fix it? I said, how much is it going to cost? He said, oh, we got to raise about $25,000. Well, after a $100,000 raise and a year goes by, we had a memorial commemoration service during Memorial Day. It drew 200 to 300 people, and I thought we were done. And he said, hey, you know, I don't think we're done. He said, you see that rec building over there and those soccer fields that are empty? I said, yeah. He said, I think that should be our next project. I said, how much is that going to cost? He said, oh, we got to raise about $1.5 to $2 million. And he was closer this time, on a percentage basis at least. So far, we've raised $2.6 million. And we raise it in a variety of ways. This last Saturday, we had a bake sale. Sold a lot of petitza. We sold over 350 sarmas and raised $4,000. But you don't get to $2.6 million doing that. We've raised $550,000 in donations from individual and businesses out of their pocket. We've gotten another $650,000, a little over, from grants from foundations and businesses. The city of Duluth and the DNR has provided us with $873,000. And in-kind contributions from businesses, unions, people that have devoted their time, labor, and materials has come in to under just $500,000. So it's a $2.6 million raise. Our community stretches beyond Gary and Duluth because the need is recognized and our contributions go directly to the project. On my way down here, I talked to one of my business partner, and she said to me, "Hey, you know what, Gary, what you're doing out there is, and with that crew is great." She said, "That's a part of the city that was neglected for 40 years. And I really have to believe that it was, but we've had a lot of hard work and a lot of volunteers, and we're making things happen out there. We kept our sport court open last summer, and people from around the city used it because the city and school districts locked their parks. People say, why a skate park? Well, and I know Mayor Nessa at the time said, that's got to be the last thing you do, and it is the last thing we're doing. We had a lot of community input, and we talked to a lot of everybody in the community, and the kids wanted the skate park. Skateboard community is a very close-knit community, even though it's spread out over the country and the state, but it's a destination point. The skate park, as Mark said, we've got $600,000 left to complete. We have $450,000 has already been put into the skate park, but we need that last $600,000. And I'll tell you what, ladies and gentlemen, that's a lot of sarma to sell. So, we're looking for help here. We're three-fourths of the way there. This will put us over the hump, and we're not getting any younger. We're going to still keep working. We're in our late 60s. You know, old Mark Rubin, as we're in our late 60s, we're going to keep going till it's finished. But we owe it to the kids to get it done as soon as possible. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next, Stephen Peterson.
Morning. Thank you, Sheriff Lippman, the St. Louis County Sheriff's Department, and the County Board of Commissioners for inviting us here today to provide feedback on the proposed body camera policy. Upon reviewing the policy, I have found a couple of items that I believe warrant discussion before approval can be considered. Number one, 426.2 states that the St. Louis County Sheriff's Office may provide deputies with access to body-worn cameras for use during the performance of their official duties. It is my belief that the word may needs to be changed to shall. If we are going to implement this system for the department, then it should not be optional. Number two, at the end of 426.14.1, it states, exception, the sheriff may withhold otherwise public data if it is clearly offensive to common sensibilities. Will you provide us with a further explanation of that sentence and also an example of a situation where that would be used? As a citizen of St. Louis County, I feel that it is important that law enforcement implements this body camera system, not only for the safety of the deputies, but also for the safety and trust of the public. As a citizen, I feel that right now there is a disconnect between citizens and law enforcement, a major lack of trust right now. I believe that this new camera system is a step in the right direction that has the potential to start mending that disconnect. I would personally like to see more opportunities for the citizens to become involved in the day-to-day operations of the Sheriff's Department. At the end of the day, everyone truly wants the same thing, no matter what walk of life we come from. I believe that having more citizen involvement will bring about a better sense of community in our county. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Next we have Roy Hamlin. Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you today?
I'm okay. Are you?
We're here. We're doing all right.
If you don't mind, I need to take this down for a minute. Well, thank you for allowing me to speak here today. I appreciate all the hard work that you people do. My wife was an employee of St. Louis County for many years, and she worked her tail off, and I know you do the same. There's an old story. How many times do you have to kick a bear in the head before he wakes up? Well, I'm awake. My name's Roy Hamlin. I grew up and have lived in Duluth and Hermantown for the last 82 years. I feel I know the area, I'm proud of it, and I love living here. I've been a principal for 29 years and in education for 37. I know a little bit about budgets. I'm not here to criticize, I'm here to explain about an injustice. And we sometimes have to ask ourselves, how do we justify injustice? I'm not here to dazzle you with a whole bunch of statistics, but I'll let you know this much. The proposed taxes for my property, and I live in a real small little place, is not 1.9%, or as this document states, the property tax base impact. When the property tax base grows, the levy is divided among more taxpayers, so individual property tax owners pay less. Well, mine went up 32%, $1,009. I don't call that a minimum impact. I think we need to take a good look at the process and find out what's wrong. This is the second time in 3 years this has happened. I went through the appeal process and it was a minimal impact. I'm not going through that again. I'm here to ask you and encourage you to use restraint, review the process, and see what you can do to change it. And if there's something in the budget that you have a question about and it begs the question why, look into it. And I know there are probably a few that you're familiar with. The document that we were given the other night regarding the budget is really not a budget. It is a document of generalities. And if you were to go through this, like I did, you'll find that for some part of it, it almost looks like it's not written correctly. Oh, I don't mean to be offensive. I'm just trying to point out a fact here. It takes courage to be a public leader. It takes courage and leadership to make a difference when you can, and you can. You haven't passed the budget yet. Hopefully, I don't know how you deal with mill rates, but I would think that could be one way you could deal with it. I met a 93-year-old woman the other day. She was in tears. She lived in her house almost all her life, and she has a proposal in front of her that her taxes are going up $800. She doesn't have $800, and she's worried. We have to ask ourselves the question, how much is enough? If you look at the 400 and whatever million dollars, you have to ask yourself, has the population really changed all that much that we have to be spending all this much money? I know this isn't the same world it was 10 years ago, but all in all, we really need to take a look at that. Two questions. How much is enough? And our former governor, Jesse Ventura, asked that question, and nobody could answer it. And the second one is, how do you justify injustice? I feel there is injustice here for the 93-year-old lady and certainly for me. And I would hope you would address that. And I thank you for your work and what you do. and hope that this can be resolved. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next, we have Chester. Good morning.
Morning. I was here a couple of years ago. Anyway, I want to restate some stuff. This cost me a restraining order. It's actually 8 to 10 feet long, cut on the Hutchinson sawmill. I snapped the ends off with an excavator. Cost me a restraining order. I just needed it for evidence, but the evidence never made it. Nobody could listen. Anyway, I started last time by saying conspiracy to commit property theft by swindle and deceit. I missed manipulation, and manipulation came in two forms. The first form is through my property being manipulated while we were out of town. True story. The only thing I want the county to know about me, really, is that I thank God daily. Thank God for where we are. The second premeditated manipulation of our property came while we were out of town, like I said. And the other one is legal. Barb Ross came to the county board in a hurry. We'd filled out some paperwork, sent some letters out for everybody. Barb Ross took the words, and she, Judge Johnson said there was no road. She said there's a road, and the county board believed her. There was no road back there. It was put there while we were out of town. So you got two forms of premeditated manipulation on our property. You got one that's physical to the property, one that's legal from Barb Ross dishonoring Judge Johnson's ruling. You got two forms of swindle back there. One just signed here, the other make it cost so doggone much you can't afford to fight it. There needs to be laws that protect property owners. And from what I understand, there kind of are, but when you get a county attorney's office that's willing to go against a judge's ruling, there's a doggone problem with that. So this case has had deceit throughout. Every affidavit that I've read has non-truths on it. I couldn't find this. This is their building permit, and here last time I couldn't find this. It says frontage, public road, publicly maintained road. They marked that. You didn't. The Hutchinsons marked that. That's garbage. Here, I gave you this here. Oops, we thought we owned the property. That was in the paper, and that's not accurate at all. The only thing that is accurate is the headlines. Just completely wrong. I called the Associated Press. We wanted to do a rebuttal. I called them. I told them I can't even read your newspapers no more. True story. The restraining order that they got against me was actually ex parte restraining order, yet they knew who we were, where we were, everything. Again, I missed something. So Article 1, Section 13, private property for public use. Private property shall not be taken, destroyed, or damaged for public use without just compensation, therefore first paid or secured. That didn't happen, obviously, with oops, we thought we owned the property. Come on, that don't work. This is my, I had a printout of everything I've done wrong on this planet, and it's all you guys' garbage. Gary Bestel wanted access down there on Jarvie Road at the same time this was taking place, yet no acknowledgments were given to him. The county chose three options. They chose three options. We suggested one. They chose none of ours. The one they did choose,
if you want to take a minute and finish up, that's fine. Just we were trying to pull because we had a number of speakers today. But if you have,
I'm sorry. I didn't know. This is a cartway where Barbara speaks, and she says it's been a road built and maintained for over 40 years. Anybody want to know where the road came from? No? I'll tell you. Johnny Hutch put that road there while we were out of town. These wood slabs were cut on the Hutchinson sawmill and placed there, gravel placed on top. Never should have happened. The reason there was another cartway here, or a cartway hearing, is because we sent out this letter to the board, and it says we were gonna, the Hutchinson family disrupted natural vegetation and drainage across our properties. That's Cochise and ours. They did so by clearing the eastern border. Without our knowledge and consent, we suggest the Hutchinson family consider access across their property via Jarvie Road, which is where they should come from. And now,
Chester,
I'll cut it short.
We do have staff here today. If you've got the opportunity, you're here, and we have staff available. I would say take advantage of that today and show your things to staff. They're the ones that are going to, you know, take a look at it and go from there.
Okay, I'll cut it short then, but I sure do wanna, I got so much here, and it's just totally ridiculous. If you're gonna take people's property, it should be all square up front. There should be no games. A county attorney can't come in and tell you that it's been a road for 40 years. She turned over Judge Johnson's ruling completely, and that's wrong. That should never be allowed.
You've got a couple of papers here, too.
I want this turned to blank again.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Nate?
Failed.
Morning.
Hey, good morning. How you doing, Paul?
Good morning.
Thank you. Some of you know me, some of you don't. I'm coming about the body cams. I started, tell you a little bit about myself. I started here when I was 94, 95. Known Paul, played football at Vermillion, been here ever since. Got grandkids here now, so. So I've been over here over 25 years, so I'm invested in the area. People call me a pack sacker. It's funny. I appreciate that, but that's okay. Okay. One of the issues that people of color have here is that we're not represented. They don't have the numbers, I guess, so it doesn't matter. I don't think that should ever matter. People are people. But people of color do have issues that maybe the greater Minnesota don't understand or have. 2001, I had a friend, my best friend, he died in the back of a squad car in Hibbing. The police still worked, never gave time off, was justified. Now we moved to last year and just, I couldn't understand that this young man got killed, you know, by a deputy, two deputies, and my own eye. I had the pleasure of working with his mother, so I know her very well. Most people realize there ain't no perfect parents, ain't no perfect children. And what you start off as a young adult ain't really an indicator of who you're going to become later. He wasn't given that chance. It's really quiet on the range. I like it. I think most people don't really think much up that far that it matters to what goes on up north, but it does. I don't know why it took this young man to lose his life before cameras was introduced, but like others have said, it's better late than never. But this man is dead. I mean, it ain't no there ain't no good reason why. I read the report, I saw how I was justified. This family doesn't have any peace. I think cameras are good, but I think some things need to be in place to have some transparency. I think that's important. If you want to start bridging the trust with the community, especially people of color, I think you do need to have some no tolerance policies to people who tamper with the cameras, cut them off, they're not on, they need to be. We're in a day and age that can't happen, especially when it involves somebody's death or brutality. We also need, it's always put on the people to have access to these, these videos and stuff that happen. You have to go through some kind of paperwork, need some lawyers, and that's ridiculous. It shouldn't take all that. For if someone wants to find out what happened, a regular person should be able to do that and do so easily. Last, I think if once you have these body cameras, I think it will make people feel more comfortable, even if the officers and deputies go up to them and say, hey, I'm recording. If you want to record too, because it's for yourself, I think that'll give people some peace and feel more comfortable. One of the things I would just want you guys to understand that we started this organization, it's called VEMA. We started because there's a need for people who don't have a voice to talk. The dynamic, of the Iron Range is changing. There's more and more people coming, color, different backgrounds, as even just my children and my grandkids growing up. So this is changing. So hopefully, we'll be able to work with some of you guys about what we can do to make that easier and better. But why this is an issue, something you guys may not ever run into, is these same officers and these same deputies, get a knock on the door for a noise complaint, and guess who comes to my door about the noise complaint? One of the officers involved in my friend's death. Can I tell you the amount of, I really don't have the words for it. I don't know if you understand what that feels like, and then on top of that, get pulled over for whatever reason. And again, guess what? The officer involved in, deputy in Estevan's death was the one that pulled me over. I can't tell you the amount of pain and how people tell you, well, you should just listen. You should just listen what they say. I mean, it's just, I don't think, you guys take that in consideration, that somebody dies. And I never seen it so silent on the range until Estevan died. No one cared. No, we out there, 15 below weather, protested that, hey, something needs to be done. And people more worried about, what's happening in the woods. Oh, well, don't set off any balloons, because, it may hurt the animals. I'm like, yeah, but you got nothing to say about this man that just died? Nothing. And then they steal the memorial we built for him out there. They take the stuff, and that's the kind of response we get. So when we hear, we want to be inclusive, we that's what we want. It's a lot of lip service, a lot of time when it comes down to actions. And it's very hurtful. It makes me angry to have to go to people who don't look like you and have to explain why something is important to you. And then they turn around and do nothing about it. It's almost like, do we need people of color in these offices? So that maybe some of these changes will happen. I mean, it doesn't matter. It ain't really a pricing. Price should never be an issue for somebody's death or life, I just hope something changes. I hope these three things happen. We gotta have some transparency. We cannot, We got to have rules. If you're going to have these cameras in place, that if these things are tampered with, that's a being like, they need to be fired. We can't have, someone else did. The camera was off. We turned it off and this person is still working. We can't have that. We're in an age that we got history behind us to learn from the things that don't happen. We don't have to repeat it, which is one of the reasons why we formed this group and talking to one of the sheriffs. And shortly after that, then we have this, and it's like, we want to try to prevent that. So hopefully you guys understand, Mr. Littman, just met you. Hope I get to work with you more, that there's trauma's response. When people who look like you are constantly being killed by police, it causes a trauma. Whether that's flight, whether that's, you want to run, whether you want to fight or freeze. So I hope, that's taken into consideration in some of this stuff. So I appreciate your time. Thank y'all for listening and enjoy your day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next we have Gerald Wick. How are you, Jerry?
I can't come stand up. I can't stand. I'm the old man from, one of the old men from Toivola. I know you, Keith. I don't know the others. But my only concern here, I've been listening to Mike Lindell for the last 8, 9, 10 months regarding election integrity. And I wondered what the county board feels about the voting machines and all that.
Jerry, we don't really address, but you can ask questions to staff.
Okay.
The board doesn't address during public comment. I just am here to address it. But I just wanted you to know there's people here you can ask questions to, and they will help you out.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
That's all I have.
Okay, is there anyone else that cares to address the board that didn't get on the sign-up sheet?
Yeah, I'll address the board.
You want to state your name? I know who you are, but just for the record.
My name is Chad Walsh. Some of you guys might know me, some of you don't. I'm running for St. Louis County Sheriff in 2022 here. And I'm here, I'll address the board on behalf of the body cams. These body cams are long overdue. I've been all over this county, talked to thousands of citizens, and they want transparency and they deserve it. They do. These body cams need to be implemented. They should have been implemented many years ago. This gentleman that just came up here to speak, I side with him. He's a citizen, just like me. We shouldn't have these issues. The public wants to be involved in what we do. I'm a police officer myself. I see it. They want to be a part of what we do. We need to invite them in. Transparency, it needs to come with more than just body cams. That is the start of it. But there are so many other parts of it. And these should be available to the public. There shouldn't be discretion on when an officer can and cannot turn on a body cam. To the public, that looks like you're hiding some. To me, that looks like you're hiding some. Thank you for today. Thanks for taking the comments like the statutory says. I will say this, we need these. The citizens need them. The officers need them. It protects both sides. Long, long overdue. Thanks.
Okay. That's the end of the public comment, and we are a little overdue. Well, next for items listed on the Board of Agenda, Board Agenda Committee of the Whole, citizens will be allowed to address the board at time of motions on the floor. And we have a public.
Chair, yeah. Personal privilege.
Okay, personal privilege. We'll take that.
Thank you.
Okay, we have a public hearing. Pursuant to Resolution 21-636, adopted November 16, 2021, to consider suspension of a liquor license for failure to pay real estate. So what we're going to do is I'm going to open this meeting up and have the clerk read the introduction.
This public hearing is being conducted pursuant to Minnesota Statute Section 348, St. Louis County Ordinance Number 28, which is the liquor ordinance, and the standing rules of the county board. A copy of the standing rules is available upon request. A formal record will be made of the proceedings. Accordingly, we request that all speakers sign in and state your name and address at the beginning of your testimony. Both verbal and documentary evidence will be accepted by the board. The order for the hearing will be as follows. First, the county attorney will make the initial presentation. Second, representatives of the establishment may appear and give testimony. Third, representatives of other governmental entities may appear and give testimony.
four supporters of the proposed action may appear and give testimony. Next, opponents of the proposed action may appear and give testimony. And lastly, other comments or evidence from the public. Commissioners may question witnesses at the end of their testimony or at the end of all testimonies.
Thank you very much. County Attorney Mackey, would you be so kind? How are you this morning?
I'm doing great. Thank you, Mr. Chair, Commissioners. We're here this morning on a hearing for the suspension of a liquor license. I will be submitting to the clerk a public hearing packet that contains notices that were sent to the liquor license holder regarding this hearing. And the packet also contains real estate tax record display information for the subject property. At this time, and this was verified right before the meeting, there is $4,054.80 due as of December 31st, 2020. It's actually due now, but that number is good through the end of the year. And it remains unpaid through the beginning of this meeting here today. So with the submission of this packet, we've set the table for your consideration of a potential suspension of this license. And I didn't mention it earlier, but the license holder is Kabuma Properties, LLC, DBA, Boondocks Saloon and Grill. Thank you.
Thank you. Representatives of the affected establishment may appear and give testimony. Okay, representatives of other governmental entities may appear and give testimony. Supporters of the proposed action may appear and give testimony. Opponents of the proposed action may appear and give testimony. Other comments or evidence from the public?
Mr. Chair, I would move to close the public hearing.
Moved by Nelson, second by Boyle. Further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, motion carries. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, I would move a resolution that is included in the packet with the insertion of the date December 13th at 1:20 a.m. And that is the time at which we will impose the suspension, allowing this party until next Monday, I believe, at 1:20 a.m. It would actually be Tuesday, I'm sorry, at 1:20 a.m. in the morning to make good on the tax payments or the license will be suspended. So that's my motion, Mr. Chair.
You got a motion by Nelson?
I think you had the wrong date, Commissioner Nelson. That's yesterday. The 13th, did you say it? What date did you say?
I did. Help me out. I apologize.
Next Monday is December 20th.
Thank you, Commissioner Jewell. I looked at the calendar wrong. December 20, well, actually 21st, because it's 1:20 a.m., which is legal closing time plus the 20 minutes to clear the establishment is what I did. So thank you for that, Commissioner Jewell. I move it with that amended date.
Okay, and a second by Boyle. Okay, discussion? Hearing none. All in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, motion carries. Thank you. Move on to our next public hearing.
I was trying to move the date back, Mr. Chair, so I could hear it on one more week. Sorry, Mr. Chair.
Don't let the calendar stop you. Okay. Next, we have another public hearing. It's Resolution 21-637, adopted November 16, issuance of off-sale intoxicating liquor license to KRL Hospitality Corporation, Sportsman's Inn. Okay, so it's letter 21-535. I have officially opened up the meeting. Your time to shine, Phil.
This public hearing is being conducted pursuant to Minnesota Statute Section 348, St. Louis County Ordinance Number 28, which is the liquor ordinance, and the standing rules of the county board. A copy of the standing rules is available upon request. A formal record will be made of the proceedings. Accordingly, we request that all speakers sign in and state your name and address at the beginning of your testimony. Both verbal and documentary evidence will be accepted by the board. The order for the hearing will be as follows. First, the county attorney will make the initial presentation. Second, representatives of the establishment may appear and give testimony. Third, representatives of other governmental entities may appear and give testimony. Fourth, supporters of the proposed action may appear and give testimony. Next, opponents of the proposed action may appear and give testimony. And lastly, other comments or evidence from the public. Commissioners may question witnesses at the end of their testimony or at the end of all testimony.
Thank you. Attorney Mackey.
Yeah. Okay. Sorry, Attorney Mackey. He was trying to explain Finland hunting season to me, and it's okay.
Okay.
Ends July 3rd, starts July 4th. In Vail Township.
Starts July 3rd. And
sorry, anyway, sorry, Attorney Mackey.
It's okay. Mr. Chair, Commissioners, I'm here today with a public hearing packet relative to the application of KRL Hospitality Corp. doing business as the Sportsman Inn in Gunnison Township. The license type that's being requested is an off-sale intoxicating liquor license. The public hearing packet contains a number of different documents, and with the submission of all of these documents, there is no legal impediment to the granting of this application should the board choose to do so.
Thank you. Representatives of the affected establishment. Good morning.
Good morning. I'm Ramona Loisel, and my husband, Kevin, and I are applying for this license. We're taking over the lease of Sportsman's Inn. It's up in Gunnison Township. It's been in business for 35, 40 years. Forever with the same family, and we've actually worked there ourselves, filling in and helping out for at least 30 years. So it's a well-known establishment and very family-oriented. I don't know what else you need from me. Oh. Not a big speaker.
Mr. Chair, if I may. This is asked of all of the applicants, as I told you at the liquor committee meeting.
Mm-hmm.
You have read the mint colored booklet, or St. Louis County's liquor ordinance,
mm-hmm.
and you intend to abide by the rules within that ordinance?
Yes, we do.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay. Next, representatives of other governmental entities may appear. Supporters of proposed action. Appear and give testimony. Opponents of the proposed action may appear and give testimony. Other comments or evidence from the public? Okay.
Move to close, Chair.
Pardon?
Move to close.
Okay.
Support.
Second by McDonald. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, motion carries. Next. Move by Jewell.
Support.
Support by Musouf. Discussion?
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
I have to say this because, and it's not to this particular establishment, but during COVID, some of the most difficult businesses in the entire world to own have been in the hospitality industry. And it is just very much heartening to me to see people that are still willing to get into this business. It's an important part of our communities, these small establishments out in the rural areas especially, they become the centers of many of those communities. So it makes me feel good that I have businessmen and women that are willing to take the chance and get into the hospitality business given the difficulties of this time. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And pre-vote, I will say congratulations on the transfer to that, because I believe we will have a unanimous vote on this. Recommend everybody to stop out for some of their
Thank
great
you.
Food out there. It's in my neck of the woods. And great
commercial.
Lunch.
All right.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, motion carries. Thank you. Appreciate you coming in.
Moving consent agenda.
Okay, consent agenda moved by Boyle.
I do have something to hold on. Number 18, the board letter 21-533. There is a replacement resolution in front of you regarding some language cleanup on the Ashriver Sanitary District.
Okay, let's put that as number three.
I'll support the rest of that resolution, Mr. Chair.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. So we will move on to the regular agenda. Under finance and budget, it's the 2022 budget and property tax levy. It's letter 21-528.
I would move it, Mr. Chair.
Okay, moved by Commissioner Nelson. Is there a second?
Support
by Commissioner McDonald.
Thank you.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Chair, I do want to pull out one item for discussion in the budget. I don't know the best way or the appropriate time, but under number 25 in the outline, the Historical Society budget.
Okay.
Mr. Chair, I believe the best way to do that would be Commissioner Joel would ask to divide the question so that, that one item is pulled out of the vote.
So moved.
Okay.
And I would, as the maker of the motion, I accept that division of the question.
Okay. Okay, we'll move on.
Thank you, Chair Drugovich, commissioners. Action today, the board resolution for approval of the fiscal year 2022 budget and levy establishment has been, quite frankly, a year-long effort culminating into today's final presentation. We have spent, as you can see by the flowchart, extensive times with business planning, strategic planning within our departments. And collectively across the county, we have had multiple workshops, individual meetings with commissioners. We've had the input from a number of citizens via our website and our personal appearances. As recently as today, we heard from individuals as we look at this. And of course, whenever we have the levy, the property tax system and the valuation, classification, and distribution of the dollars is always a complex topic, and we heard about that today as well. Today, however, we are focused on the actual budget itself, and I'll walk at a very high level through that, but I wanted to spend some time just reinforcing the goals and priorities of this board and our view towards the budget. We've talked consistently about the mission of promoting public health and safety, investments in ensuring sound infrastructure, and that can be people infrastructure, it can be technology infrastructure, roads and bridges, buildings, there's other forms of infrastructure. We are uniquely poised and have the opportunity to embrace our natural resources. And of course, this board has been all about supporting an environment where communities can prosper. We continue to focus on economic development and helping communities prosper. And also the somewhat sad awareness that substance abuse and mental health challenges continue to be a significant challenge for this nation, this county, and this board, and this budget continues to support investments in those critical arenas. We continue to hear a lot about COVID, again, unfortunately, and that is a challenge that's reflected in here as we look at investments and funding to support the delivery of our public health system, investments in technology around tracking and cybersecurity, looking at different ways and new ways to bring people on board, to develop training, to utilize a mobile workforce, while always focused on continuing to deliver services to our residents. Of course, we continue to track the financial aspects of that, and this budget does reflect the addition of monies for the American Rescue Plan Act that the county will be receiving and investing in these issues related to the COVID pandemic. As a means of an overview, just very briefly, and I'm going to talk about the resolution a little bit more in depth, because that brings it all together from an accounting and fiscal management standpoint, and I will highlight the work of the auditor's office at that point. But of course, I mentioned customer service and program effectiveness and outreach is a top priority of this board and the departments that have developed these budgets. This budget does reflect additional investments in public work fleet equipment and in facilities, and supports the consolidation of five locations for our truck stations into three that meet the standards and expectations of today's equipment, and response to snow events and other year-round activities. It supports infrastructure investments, including in technology and cybersecurity. It honors and acknowledges our salary commitments and acknowledges that there are market pressures around salaries in particular. As I noted, we continue to invest in mental health and substance use disorder services, including additional staff person, and as well as staff to support the good news of additional permitting requests and our efforts around economic development. And again, I would note that the second half of the American Rescue Plan Act, the ARPA monies, is reflected in this budget. This board has had extensive discussion around a framework for the use of that, and we'll have more discussion in the upcoming Committee of the Whole meeting on this topic as well. I just wanted to, and I know this is a high level, but highlight the investment areas broadly that this budget reflects. The total budget is approximately $463 million. That's a significant number. The money is being invested and the services are being supported, our 25% of that budget is supporting our activities around public health and human services. And I mentioned the additional investment in mental health and COVID impacts in the public health arena. Public Works reflects the additional facilities and fleet equipment investments, and supports a $63 million construction budget that's anticipated for this coming year. I do recall a decade plus ago when I came on the board, I think we were looking at a number half to two-thirds of that as a normal construction season. Well, Public Works has far exceeded that, and circumstances have, in some cases, not been good, for instance, flooding, but we've been able to transform those scenarios and really improve a lot of our network and raise our road quality index and our safety measures on roads, the 3,000 miles of roads and 600 bridges that encompass St. Louis County. Public safety, a notable investment here in public safety, and that includes our attorney's office. It includes Arrowhead Regional Corrections, our joint partnership with the five-county area. And, of course, it reflects our sheriff and law enforcement in jail and emergency management responsibilities and investments. General government is just that. Everything from administration to assessor's office to our recorders and vital records and so many other departments. And that's reflected here as well. I noted the ARPA investment, and then you see the enterprise funds, such as our land and minerals funds and things like that. So the budget is $463 million, and that's supported primarily by state and federal revenues, the 35 to 36%, and approximately a third by levy supports, and then other revenues, licenses and fees and permits make up the remaining 30+%. This contemplates an adopted budget of 1,881 employees, which is essentially flat from where we are today. I know we are looking at one position supporting our human resources area to, in response to the pandemic and to increasing workload with onboarding and compensation and recruitment. But it's essentially flat from where we are as of today. There's additional budget information, and we'll leave this reminder on the screen through our Budget Explorer and accessing the website for those that want to look at more at the development. With the permission of the chair, I would just quickly walk through the resolution at a high level and reinforce what Director Graber walked us through at the Committee of the Whole 2 weeks ago. The budget resolution, again, I want to begin with by saying that this is really more of the total wrap-up and the accounting and financial management details of that $463 million. And I want to really give a shout-out to Auditor Nielsen and her team, who have supported Bree and Brian as they've worked hard on the budget side of this. But from an accounting perspective, Angie Petullo and Kristen Christensen have been extraordinary in their support. And a lot of this resolution reflects the accounting detail, including, one, the levy breakout by fund type, including the use of approximately $7 million to support debt. And that is almost a flat number again. That hasn't increased significantly. With respect to the accounting detail, the next half dozen pages, quite frankly, are breakout by fund, by type of assets, by type of expenditure. This is all the information that is required for financial management purposes and to set the budget in place via the accounting system. You'll see proposed investments and the means of financing, and that is all summarized by each individual department and area or activity. The budget document itself, the verbal narrative, the first several items are very important because it talks about the carryover, the use of encumbrances and fund balances and appropriations, etc., and the designation of using portions of the unassigned portions of our fund balances for cash flow purposes to ensure liquidity and smooth operations of the county. It establishes our complement, notes the positions that we're adding and some that we're eliminating in items 15 and 16. It establishes also in the previous, in item 13, the healthcare premium levels, which will also be noted in human resources area, which stayed flat for our employees this year. The general fund and each of the areas will talk about assigned and committed fund balances. Those are all, again, to ensure the financial integrity of the system. The commissioner's salaries is established at approximately $70,074. As we look at item 25, aid to other agencies, that's the item that I believe has been pulled down that we will talk in a separate discussion. But I would note that there are aid to other agencies, including the library system, our fair associations, community fairs, other youth activities that this board continues to support, as well as the ATV Joint Powers Board is a new addition this year. And of course, Camp Esquagma can't be forgotten. And I'm looking forward to a full season coming up this year. And we will talk more about eight other agencies. And I believe specifically, as was highlighted by Commissioner Jewell, the Historical Society. Each area and department has the prescribed financial language, highlights internal service arrangements, authorization to enter into certain commission agreements and the like, and that is the same format for each and every department as it is presented there, including by fund, where you'll see, for instance, on item 48, Public Health and Human Services, item 56, we'll be looking at Land and Minerals Department. Item 50 talks about Public Works. And again, this is the detailed support the dialogue and the input from the board and translate that into specific numbers and specific debits and credits in accordance with best accounting practices. You'll note that we also talk about the use of the Environmental Trust Fund and how we continue to support septic loan programming and support our staff work in that area, which has been ever increasing, and that's generally a good sign when we're seeing more permitting activity going on with respect to physical planning or to septic permits and the like. You'll see the transfers and that have been approved and reflect the direction of this board and the work of the accounting or the auditor's office with the administration. And so this is a very detailed document that does reflect, again, in summary, the direction of this board, the support of these critical investments, and the budget that totals approximately $463 million. So with that, I would turn it back to you, Chair Dragovich.
And if Commissioner Nelson had a comment or a question, and then we'll, I believe you want to, we'll break it down.
We'll talk about it separately.
Yep.
Why do we do it?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is to the overall budget with item number 25 removed from that as a division of the question. Year in and year out, we've refined and we continue to get better at the budget as a whole. And that reflects really year-round activity on this budget. We're already working on the budget for 2023, not 2022, 2023, and beyond, quite frankly. And the importance of that is in a county the size of St. Louis, it is imperative that we try to manage that over a two-year cycle or over a three-year cycle, given the fact that, of course, that budget is affected by, as an example, just one example, we're affected by the three-year average of taconite production, which right now happens to be a record year this year. But because of the three-year averaging, we have to kind of watch that number as it goes up and down and fluctuates. But I want to make sure to acknowledge, first of all, the courage of this board in the investments that have been made over this past year, those investments in public works, in particular those three garages, that takes courage. It's not something that just happens. And those garages will be built using local labor, period, because that's St. Louis County's policy. But that investment in roads, when you look at the investment in roads today, as Administrator Gray pointed out, in direct contrast to what it was 10 years ago, there was a lot of courage on this board that voted to put sales tax in to investments in our roads. Those were roads not only for the convenience of the motoring public, but folks, if we look at our safety record on those roads over the last several years, it's remarkable. It's remarkable the progress that's been made in terms of safety on our county roads. So all of those investments are paying dividends. The investments in health and human services, the investments in this pandemic. Thank you, Commissioner Boyle, Commissioner Jewell, for your work in that area. It's truly something that I know as a commissioner who focuses more on finances and more on public works, and planning issues, I truly appreciate the efforts that are being put in those other areas. But I want to take just a moment to acknowledge the fact that there are 10 elected officials in St. Louis County. And in all of my tenure, we have never had an issue with another elected official. So I want to acknowledge Attorney Mackey, Sheriff Lippman, and of course, Auditor Nielsen, for their, as elected officials, they don't have to play nice in the sandbox, so to speak, but year in and year out, we, St. Louis County, are an example for for all of Northern Minnesota in how we budget and in how we work together as a board with our other elected officials. So covering them, I cannot miss. Every one of you has heard me over the years give Administrator Gray a hard time about almost everything I can think of. But the reality is that some years ago, he was brought here to stabilize the administrative department of St. Louis County. To be here through his budget, where he actually is here through the budget that he presents to this board, and he's done that for over 10 years now. And that is that stabilization of administration has served the people of St. Louis County very, very well. His team, of course, has changed somewhat over those years, but the team is just as strong as it's ever been. And I think if in all coaching and it's next person up, right? We've had that, and it really has served, again, the people of St. Louis County very well. I also want to acknowledge, having acknowledged our, whatever we call our assistant administrator and our finance person. By the way, Brianne rose to the top of administration for me today because she still has the customer service sign up in her office. I was there this morning and I saw it. That's brownie points right up to the top. But the fact is that our administrative team, our team over in the auditor's office, every one of our department heads, they live this budget every day. And they're part of what puts this budget together. For commissioners, we have to go out and ask people to support this budget. I have no issue in asking people to support this budget. It's not perfect. It never will be. But it's a good budget. It reflects the environment in which we are living today. And it reflects the improvements that we're trying to make in our community as a whole. And that's at all levels. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you.
Thanks, Chair Yudovich. Well, one, I am impressed with Brianne's attempts at brownie points. That definitely worked. And I wanna address a couple of things that we heard today that are really fair questions too, and talk about what has been my first time through this whole process. So I know some of these presentations that we give are kind of big overviews. And like Commissioner Nelson said, they're overviews of months of work. And so when we work with Brianne Graber and our staff here, they're going through the line item budgets of every department and saying, where is there any flexibility? And we're an implementation arm. So most of what we're doing, we have to do, but it's a matter of doing it well and doing it in some of the hardest circumstances that I've ever been in Duluth in. I mean, I've seen the impacts of the opioid crisis. I've seen how much domestic abuse has increased over the pandemic and affected families. I mean, we're seeing this every day. We're also seeing the needs that we've always seen in roads and in making sure that we need our plowing done and all of that. So it got to the point where literally the statement was made, if you want to cut anymore, you'll have to tell me which positions, right? And so we take that very seriously, and we take it seriously because of what you're also sharing, which is a very heavy burden of property taxes that we're asking. And it's not just the budget. You're right that some property taxes aren't going up just under 2%. Your assessments are changing. Property values are going up, and yet if you want to stay in your home on a fixed income, then you might not be able to do that. And one of the things we don't talk about as much in this budget, but is a big part of it, is our revenue. And so one of the big things that we'll be working on is getting more revenue in our legislative session too. There is PILT reform, which sounds super boring, so it's probably not gonna be quoted in the paper. But we have over 900,000 acres of tax forfeit land where we don't get any property tax revenue from that. And the state needs to be doing more to offset that. And that's what PILT reform is about. Like, we're working on this, we're working on land use and looking at carbon credits, there's things that aren't just good for the environment, but they'll increase our revenue because we don't want to tax people out of their homes. So thank you for showing up to what is a pretty long board meeting. Please continue to reach out and be part of that process. We'd be happy to dig into the numbers with you. Thank you to staff and the elected officials for doing this incredible work and for choosing not just to like check off the box of what we need to do for the state, but to do it well in our interventions. So thank you.
Thank you, Chair Jurkovich. Again, being involved in this process now for my third year, I'm very impressed with how we do the process. It is amazing, you know, when we're talking in the spring about 23 budget, we're just starting 22, and you know, you look at, as Commissioner Nelson said, the investments we are making in the garages, and as we always say, the garage in Embarrass was built in 1934 and still has outdoor toilets for our workers. To upgrade that is going to be huge, along with the other two campuses. And to have somebody willing to tackle the finance, as Commissioner Nelson does, and does a wonderful job with that. And I want to personally thank him on behalf of the board for what he does in the financial part of it, and the rest of the board as well. As we work together to put together a document with the help of administration and also our other elected officials, it is amazing. And when we go to other parts of the state, people talk about, and we've seen it, people want to live in St. Louis County. And people want to emulate what we do as a board and as other elected officials in St. Louis County, because people ask us, you know, what would St. Louis County do? And I think that's something that is good for us, will continue to be good for us, but we're only as good as the team that we have formed. And it's been a pleasure in the 3 years to watch this whole thing develop and take it in as, and I learn something new about St. Louis County every single day. And with the help of my other commissioners and other elected officials, administration, we'll continue to do that. So thanks, everybody. And I'm in full support of this budget. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Okay. So we're going to break this
vote
down
on the first half.
First, yeah, we'll break it down. Okay. So without any other comments, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Okay. Motion carries.
Mr. Chair, I would move item number 25.
And I'll second.
Okay. Discussion, please.
Thank you, Chair Jugovich. Commissioners, I did briefly talk to this portion of the budget during the overview of the budget resolution. This is the area that highlights aid to other agencies. You see those agencies are entities detailed in the box or the chart that's there. I would note that the Arrowhead Library System is based on a levy calculation or that's provided to us, and it reflects our share of the investment in those operations. We talked briefly about Campus Esquagamah and then the further investments in kids around the fair associations and the many people that attend that and the programming there, our community fairs, youth activities programming. State fire aid is something that's been a long time part of the budget, has been the Duluth Seaway Port Authority, North Shore Management Board, and then I did highlight that the Northeastern Regional ATV Joint Powers Board, that's a seed funding to take that important activity on. And I want to thank in particular Commissioner McDonald for his leadership on that and the support of this entire board to have a cohesive point as we look at trail planning efforts. I think along with Kuching and Lake Counties, this is a good project. This aid to other agencies also does include the significant support that this county has historically and continues to invest in the St. Louis County Historical Society, which includes also the range affiliates as well as Veterans Memorial Hall as part of the overall funding that is directed towards to the Historical Society. With that, I'll turn it back to you, Chair Jurgovich, and to Commissioner Jewell.
Thank you, Chair Jurgovich. Obviously, I am not pulling the whole, all of the items down, but because of the nature of this, we're pulling them all. I'm speaking only to the Historical Society. And I want to say at the beginning that we have the opportunity for an amazing organization which can, with all its artifacts and history here in St. Louis County, can be an amazing place. However, for 11 years that I've been part of budget considerations, we have had trouble with the St. Louis County Historical Society. In my very first year, they tried to do the classic end run in which they had talked to mom, so they went to dad, they asked the same question and see if they got a different answer. And I only realized after I had said yes that they'd already been told no. And so it was my first example of the kind of behavior they would be involved in. And they continued that off and on until finally, in part because the need to resolve issues related to the depot itself, where they reside, came to a head in which we had to do something. And as everybody remembers, a committee was appointed, former Commissioner Olson, Commissioner Boyle, myself, and Commissioner Jurgovich as an alternate were appointed to that committee. We spent 18 months figuring out how to move forward with the depot. It was an amazing investment of time by staff, by everyone else who is involved, and the Historical Society regularly and consistently put up roadblocks. They caused trouble in numerous ways along the way and refused to sign a lease agreement at the end for months, going well beyond the identified timeline and into the next year, as I remember, in which they did not sign that. There weren't any particular reasons that we could identify internally why that would be true. The other thing that has been true consistently is at the very end of the budget, so on the last day, last time we meet, suddenly the budget is up in the air. And they met with administration a couple of weeks ago, could not answer any of the questions administration had for them. In fact, I'm told they spent the first hour and 10 minutes talking about other things and not allowing administrative staff to ask questions or get to the written questions they had sent them. And then when they finally did get to the questions, they did not have answers to those questions about their budget. Simple and regular things. Now, I have to tell you, had they been in the room, which we expected, I have a series of questions I was going to ask administration to clarify what has happened about timelines for budgets to be presented, about what is expected, etc. And I think you would have learned that they get a check mark in the negative for most of those questions. I'm not going to ask them, obviously. They're not here. I don't think it makes sense to do so. But after that meeting, they did another little thing like they did that first time I participated in the budget. They went behind the back of administration and our manager of the depot, and they started trying to undermine her with other members who are there at the depot. It's simply unacceptable. We would never accept this under any other circumstance. And I have never, ever done this in my 11 years, pulled something out. But the reason I'm pulling it out is to make clear that this can't continue. We fund them an amazing amount of money, except for the Library Association, which we don't have any control over. That's set by state statute, how much we put in. We give them more money than any other nonprofit in St. Louis County, and they treat us like blankety blank. I mean, really, wait, what in the world? How can this be true? And this year, they're asking for even more. But when we ask questions about this, they presented a new budget that no longer includes some of the things they were asking money for. It includes the money, but is no longer pointed at the issue of storage, which is a huge issue that we have to answer. And I know Commissioner Nelson was along for the tour of the depot, and we saw some of these issues. Storage has to be dealt with. The fact that they alleviated it from the budget, it's beyond my comprehension. And the fact is, I ran a nonprofit for a long time. I have been a participant in starting and being the board chair of a number of nonprofits. Normally, grantors give you the money in chunks and don't continue it if you don't do what you said you are going to do. And I, in one instance, have had that experience because we clearly weren't meeting expectations. So I know what that looks like and what it feels like. I'm pulling this down. I will vote to move it forward, but I want you to know that it is my expectation that we will have a contract with the Historical Society, and that contract will identify actual objectives that they will accomplish. We will pay them for the first half of the year and hold the second half until such time as they have shown that they have accomplished the actions they said they would do in the first 6 months. We've had a lot of discussion. The administrator would like to not do this kind of, but the fact is, I don't know. Commissioner Nelson could probably answer this. I am sure we have talked about holding their feet to the fire three times in my tenure, and we never do it. Now, we also have to make sure that the veterans get funded, that the affiliates on the range get funded. So we will do that in the contract, but we will make clear they don't get funding if they don't change their ways. And this came out of a meeting, you should know, with the existing members of the committee, which now includes Commissioner Grimm, Commissioner Boyle, myself, Assistant Administrator Pritzinger, and our Budget Director, Brie Graber, and on the phone, immune from us going after him was Administrator Gray. So, and I will say, I don't generally get really aggravated about some kinds of behavior like this, but the fact that it's gone on for 11 years, and I guess longer, is, I just can't, it's got to stop. They gotta do it different. because we're giving them way too much money. And we don't even know, folks, what they use the money for, because their budget is really opaque. So enough said, no questions to ask.
Okay, thank you. We'll go to Commissioner Boyle, then Nelson, and then we'll
Okay. Thank you, Chair, and I just want to echo some of the words that were said by Commissioner Poole. You know, this is my eighth year around the sun regarding our budget, and so much has done so well. But it's continuing to be a struggle with the Historical Society, and I don't think there's any commissioners on this board that haven't personally had or seen what has been going on. We had a meeting yesterday, you know, it comes to the point where, you know, we're the largest funder of this organization, and I feel it's our due diligence, our duty, that we're overseeing taxpayers' dollars that are going to this historical society, that we're on the same level as them. And I just haven't seen that. There's not a commissioner on this board that's not supportive of our affiliates up north. I think they do an excellent job. As our veterans, we've always been supportive of them and will continue to always be supportive of them. But the lack of transparency and communication between our administration and the leadership with the Historical Society has to change. We have invested, as Commissioner Jewell said, so much time into righting the ship of the depot to make it available for the next 100 years for folks to enjoy across St. Louis County, and for a place for nonprofits to thrive at some of the cheapest per square footage you'll ever see. And that was the initial vision when the county took over the depot back in the 70s. And we're continuing that trend, whether it's putting in a director that we just did about 2 years ago that's doing amazing things, to the investment of bonding dollars for infrastructure, which we've already started. It's another big ask this year that we're gonna support too. But it's so our great grandkids can enjoy this beautiful space and continue the legend, which is the depot. But with that being said, I think there's gonna be some strong meetings with administration, ourselves, and historical leadership to make this work, because at this point, it's not working very well. And it's my hope that in the next 3 months we can iron this out, but I think this is a fair warning that we can even have some tough meetings with the staff at the Historical Society. So thank you, Chair.
Thank you. We'll go to Nelson and then Grim.
Thank you, Chair Commissioner Yugovich. Earlier I talked about courage of commissioners. Thank you, Commissioner Jewell. Thank you, Commissioner Boyle. That takes courage. I know you're standing up on something that's in your district, but I want to make it very clear. We're not talking about the depot's issues, because we are clearly investing in and trying to solve all of the issues surrounding the depot, including considerable capital investment by this board and by the people of this county. I want to make sure that those two are separated, because we have a big request in front of the state of Minnesota right now that for bonding, which I hope they are very supportive of, because this depot is an incredible piece of our greater community, and it extends far into Wisconsin. It extends into Pine County and up into Cook County, and I mean, those organizations are the organizations for the entire area. Some years back, as the chair of this board, I appointed the subcommittee to work on the depot on the Historical Society, and folks, I apologize. I felt like I was punishing you at that time, appointing you to that board, but y'all did some incredible work. We've come a long ways, but we still have a ways to go. And I want to acknowledge that as this commissioner will be supportive of whatever you all come up with down here for that entity and how we can make it better and how we can continue to move forward. But again, thank you for your courage on this one, because I was tired of it 12, 14 years ago and didn't really want to take it on because it was not in, you know, I felt like I was picking on the city of Duluth, but I'm not. It's the St. Louis County Historical Society that certainly can get better, and I want to work with them to make sure that we accomplish that. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Yeah, I just have a quick comment. And in part, I think Commissioner Jewell had stated, I just want to be clear that, like, you had stated that we will support Veterans Memorial Hall and support veterans. You're talking about the rest of it that we're setting kind of expectations on and evaluating. There's some really wonderful work being done, but it's very clear right now we need to look at the expectations that we have for our public tax dollars, being clear about that as a county board and working with the Historical Society to set parameters and then to check back in on that contract too. So thank you for the context everyone gave, and we'll be doing some hard work ahead.
Chair?
Yeah. Go ahead. I'm going to go to Commissioner McDowell, yep. Then I'll go back to Commissioner Jewell.
Thank you, Chair Drugovich. Again, coming from a family of history teachers, I am a huge supporter of the Historical Society, Vets Hall, the affiliates. I mean, I see in my district all the good work the affiliates do and the people that, you know, donate their time and talent to assist in doing those tough jobs with the affiliates. And, you know, you talk about veterans and Vets Hall. You look at what we have and what it could be, and I'm excited for what the future brings. And, you know, we're looking at a new feature in there with the county built on iron. And I think that's a place where we can do a lot of education and also bring in the historical part of it. And those projects are just going to help us as we revitalize or take the depot to another level. And I look forward to working with the Historical Society in getting these things accomplished. So that's all I have, Mr. Chair.
Chair Drugovich, I will absolutely second what Commissioner Nelson said about the depot. We want the depot to be successful. We have done a ton of work in moving toward that. We have hired an amazing director. And part of the reason I pulled this down is because of what happened after that budget meeting. The fact that they went behind the depot director's back and tried to undermine her and us is simply unacceptable. I mean, I don't generally give money to people who come along and then try and destroy my car or something. You know, it's not like that. That makes sense. So I want to say that the history here has been that they come with their army of folks and try and push us into a corner to continue doing what we've always done. And we have wonderful things. They will say, if you don't give us our money, we can't fund the vets and we can't fund the affiliates. We are going to develop a contract in which we assure that those things get funded. But the contract is not going to simply let them use the money any way they see fit and try and stab us in the back at the same time. You know, it's just unacceptable. We want the depot to work and be good for everyone who lives in St. Louis County and the surrounding region. The other thing we discussed yesterday is the idea. So Historical Society, we talked about whether or not we could issue an RFP and have somebody else run the Historical Society. We actually can, Commissioner Nelson, but only if we ask the state of Minnesota to de-designate the St. Louis Historical Society. And I will say, I think that is an interesting notion if they can't get their act together. So they have this next year, the first 6 months to show that they can start doing stuff, and the second months to really get in a good place. And we hold the cards to ask the Minnesota Historical Society to de-designate them and allow us to find someone new to run it. So with that, I will say, and I will say the other person who was part of this conversation was one of our lead county attorneys, Nick Campanario, making sure we didn't step into any thickets that we want to stay out of. So we, I think, are in a good place for doing some things. And as I said, I'll support this, but there are going to be some negotiations that take place in the first weeks of the new year to get that contract hammered out. Thank you.
So Chair Jugovich, and I want to thank all the commissioners who have chimed in and acknowledge the discussions, ongoing discussions around organizational effectiveness, relationships, revenue enhancements, space utilization, storage, and thanks for to each of you for that input and the support and the hard work of, in particular, Deputy Administrator Fritzinger and Budget Director Graber, as well as our Depot Director Mary Tennis, who has just been brought some real vitality, and I want to continue to thank the board for that investment, of which one of the key tenants is the Historical Society. So budget-related wise, the only other thing I wanted to clarify is that this aid to other agencies was increased by approximately $15,000. That reflects the desire of this board to continue to recognize the work of the affiliates, and that money is intended to be directed to the affiliates. So the budget is up approximately $15,000, which reflects $2,500 per affiliate, I believe. So just for that awareness, that's the budget increase, but it was specifically directed towards affiliate investment.
Mr. Chair, and I apologize for shaking my head no, Commissioner Jewell. We tried de-designating them a number of years ago. That seems like a reasonable road. It's not a very successful road, but we, in state statute, we have the authority to levy for our Historical Society. And but this board controls that amount, and that's really what it gets to. And so that de-designating, it certainly is an option. But I can tell you that I was trying to think the exact year, but I believe it was 14 or 15 years ago, under then Attorney Mitchell, that we made a big run at that and were roundly shot down by the state. So there's the possibility exists, but thank you guys for your work down here on that. It's been a big frustration of mine over the years. I have no doubt we're going to get this right. And in government, it just takes time sometimes to fix these relationships. And again, thank you all for your work on it.
Anyone else with comments, questions? Okay, seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Motion carries. Thank you. Next, we go to Public Safety and Corrections. The Sheriff's Office purchases an implementation of body worn cameras. It's letter 21-532.
Yep. So this is the only... I'm planning to move it.
Okay.
Yeah, this is the only
I'll
agenda
support
item.
Okay, there's sure. Okay. Yeah. And then we'll go to discussion. Okay, we've got a motion, a support. Okay.
Administrator.
And then I want to turn it over to Administrator Gray for framing and acknowledge that Sheriff Lippman is here to answer any questions.
Chair Jugovich, Commissioners, Commissioner Grimm, thank you. The action before the board is a request to for the purchase of body-worn cameras and other supporting equipment needs. This is a, as we've discussed, and I do want to thank those citizens who previously spoke to this issue at the comment period of the board, and we appreciate and we're seeking that input. I wanted to acknowledge that. The first step is to hear from citizens as well as to determine that the needs that this would create. Before the board is the request for a five-year contract that totals approximately $790,000. The sheriff and his team and administration have been anticipating this movement for some time, working with the previous chair and current chair of public safety as we set aside investments or money to support this investment. You'll see that the body cameras, the docking stations, the bundling with licensing and all this stuff, it's a very complex, and I want to thank the sheriff's office for their hard work to identify the appropriate vendor, working with our purchasing and procurement department, and we have a five-year payment plan that is reflected here. So the action before the board today is focused on the purchase of the equipment and of the body-worn camera bundle, if you will, from Axon Enterprises, payable over 5 years in the amount of $790,000. Initial funding has been established within the Information Technology Fund in the amount of $600,000, and we will continue as the payments become due to work to identify the remaining gap, but it's important to take this step now, and I would turn it over back to the chair, and a note again that the sheriff and his team, Under Sheriff Okoski is here, as well as our deputy who did such a great job of walking us through the equipment piece, and at that time also talking about the policy that continues to be worked on.
Thank you. Chair Flipman, would you care to?
Nothing, Mr. Chair, other than if there's any questions from the board.
I have a question for Sheriff Levin.
It's only so that I can do this. Because I heard that our sheriff saved a life this past weekend.
Yeah.
And, it's, you know, isn't it amazing how people can rise to those occasions? And I wanted to acknowledge that.
Mr. Chair and Commissioner.
So I don't have any questions.
No, Commissioner Nelson, I appreciate the recognition. I'm not quite so fond of all the attention, but I was just in the right place at the right time. Actually, this board deserves a lot of credit, the present board and the administration, as well as past boards, making the investment in me. The training kicked in. I have no other explanation for the actions that I took, but I also need to compliment the others that were with me. I was on the ice playing a team sport, and the save was also a team save. So I thank you, Commissioner Nelson.
Mr. Chair, thank you for that. You don't get those opportunities very often, okay? And maybe in all of those years, those lifesaver awards that the Sheriff's Department has given out, the next go-around, I would just expect that I'm going to see Sheriff Lippman on that list.
Thank you. Just for the record, though, it's not Ramsey County.
Yeah, so sorry to call you back up, Sheriff Lippman, but I have a couple questions for you as well. I wanted to follow up on some of the questions that were posed by the community and kind of give a chance to respond to that, too. So I'm curious about elaborating on that exception for when you can withhold data, if you can explain that. It sounded like if there was something that was publicly offensive, I'm assuming that's around swear words or things like that, but if you could give some kind of elaboration on that, as well as the opportunities that we can have for citizens to become more involved, and what are the consequences that we can see for when if people if officers have turned off their camera or something like that.
Mr. Chair or Madam Chair, let me address the first question. The language in the policy is actually repetitive or duplicative of what the language within Chapter 1382, which already provides governmental entities the ability to withhold any form of information that is offensive. So I don't know that there's anything unique really about that language within the policy that should cause anybody real concern. I've been doing this job now 19 years. I cannot think of one time where I've withheld what would otherwise be considered public data because of that exception. We have our attorney here, Attorney Mackey. Maybe there's some other instance in county government where we've used that, but I think the most likely scenario of data that would rise to that level that would possibly be withheld would likely be created or come from the sheriff's office, either through reports, dash cam, video cam, or crime scene photos. So the other question about public involvement, it's a good question. You know, this, I've been doing this job a long time. I also always welcome public input and comment. I've struck up a dialogue and I think a relationship with Nathaniel back there today. Over the past 2 years, right? He's had a series of meetings with the command staff of this office up on the range. I continue to welcome that, encourage it, whether it's with his group or any other. So I hope that, and then I think there was one other question you had, Commissioner.
One of the questions that had come up was the kind of tolerance policies for if cameras are turned off or if evidence is tampered with.
Well, I mean, yeah that's all right. Under the policy and under the body worn camera program, supervisors in each of the three duty stations and the various locations within St. Louis County are going to be monitoring that. We will be for performance issues, occasionally monitoring the body worn camera data. If it comes to the attention of a supervisor or to me that the camera has not been activated when the policy says it should be, it'll be dealt with appropriately. And if in the most unlikely instance that a deputy would actually be manipulating or tampering or deleting data, the same would happen. We would be dealing with that immediately.
Anyone else? Thank you very much. Appreciate
okay.
it.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Okay, if there's no further comments or questions.
Yes. I just have one other comment. I just want to say I'm really supportive of this and want to commend our sheriff's office for the work that you've done with this. It makes it a lot easier as a board to know that you've done the work at looking at the technology, at looking at the funding, and of bringing this forward to us too. What people have spoke to today, I just want to acknowledge that you're right, this isn't about money. It is about the truth and it's about people's lives. And this is a way we can support the sheriff's office and we can support the community to try and bridge some of these divides that we have. So we've had incredible leadership in the sheriff's office, and I really want to take a moment to acknowledge that. And also that this is ongoing work when we have these discussions of once we've implemented it, I'm sure we'll see that we need some adjustments too. And we need to be looking at those policies too. And as chair of public safety, I'm really excited about the work ahead and appreciative of this moment too. So thank you.
Okay. All in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, motion carries. Thank you. Next, we will move on to environment and natural resources. We've got the letter that was brought down, 21-533. It was a replacement.
I would move that.
Second.
Moved by McDonald, second by Nelson. Okay. All right.
Thank you, Chair Jugovich, and I know that Commissioner McDonough can talk to this as well, but as we discussed at the Committee of the Whole, we wanted to make ensure that this was clearly communicated as a grant to the Ash River District, Sanitary District, and so there's a simple wording change that deleted advance to grant, which is consistent with the understanding and expectation of this board and support of this investment to leverage additional dollars through the Minnesota Clean Water Fund. So there is no substantial change in terms of narrative or the whereas, except that the resolution does reflect that the 25% local match identified by the county board is an advance to the district to match those grant funds.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And again, I appreciate the work from administration. And I know one of the whereas is in there on September 17th, 2020, the Solid Waste and Septic Committee recommended district request be rewarded as a grant from the Environmental Trust Fund. And there's some other language changes in there regarding the grant stuff. So I definitely like to thank Administrator Gray and Deputy Administrator Fritzinger for the cleanup on this as we get this Ash River Sanitary District off the ground and working towards the much needed project up there in Ash River. And again, just for everybody's knowledge, it is an unorganized township. Thus, the county board is the governing body for that area. So thank you very much. That's all I have, Mr. Chair.
Okay. Any questions or comments? We'll move right to a vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, motion carries. Thank you. We'll need to recess and then come back. We'll do board committee board. So if everyone is...
I'm ready to go, Mr. Chair, with housing and redevelopment, if that's all right with you.
Sure.
Yes.
Commissioner Musoff here, Commissioner Jugovich, and Chair Commissioner Nelson.
Here.
I am here too. I was just
We have you, Commissioner Jewell, as present, okay? Thank you. The first order of business is to approve the minutes of the September 7th, 2021 meeting, moved by Commissioner Jugovich, supported by Commissioner Musoff. Discussion on the minutes. Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. The motion is carried. Next order of business is under the HRA, it's the MCPP application, board letter 21-07. And I would move it. Is there support?
Support.
Supported by Commissioner McDonald. And I would turn to our executive director, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you, commissioners. In front of you, the HRA board is requested to authorize application to participate in the Minnesota Housing Finance Agency's Minnesota City Participation Program. Under the Minnesota City Participation Program, Minnesota Housing sells bonds on behalf of local governments to assist them in meeting local housing goals. The benefits of the program are lower interest rates and closing costs and no administrative fees to the participants. The bond proceeds supply funding for home mortgages available to low and moderate income and first-time home buyers. The program is administered entirely by Minnesota Housing, and St. Louis County citizens access funding from approved mortgage originators throughout the county. St. Louis County has historically been one of the higher volume users of this funding in the state. County mortgage originators have accessed nearly $100 million to assist 908 families since the inception in the year 2004. During 2021, the county originators processed 110 loans and accessed $13.5 million. The 2021 allocation was $2.9 million, meaning loan originators accessed unused funding from other areas of the state to achieve the $13.5 million. There are no penalties or fees associated with over or under usage of this funding. It is recommended that the HRA board adopt an attached resolution authorizing the submission of an application to participate in the Minnesota Housing MCPP program for 2022.
Thank you, Director Johnson. What an incredible program that has served the citizens of St. Louis County so well because of our involvement and our hard work in making sure that that those monies are available. Questions, concerns, comments from anyone? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by the sign aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. A motion is carried. A motion to adjourn would be in order.
So moved.
Moved by Commissioner Gruhl. I'm sorry. Supported by Commissioner Mutsoff. All those in favor signify by the sign aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. The motion is carried. Mr. Chair, that's all we have under the Housing and Redevelopment Authority for today.
Thank you. Let's. Is everyone okay to break for lunch?
What time are we going to come back?
Well, 4 o'clock.
Chair, can we have an hour and 15?
Yes.
It's hard in downtown Duluth.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. To our county board meeting, we will commence with the committee of the whole. Clerk Chapman, would you do a roll call, please?
Commissioner Jewell?
Here.
Commissioner Boyle?
Here.
Commissioner Grimm?
Here.
Commissioner McDonald?
Here.
Commissioner Mutsoff?
Here.
Commissioner Nelson?
Here.
And here, Commissioner Yugovich?
Present. Thank you. Okay, consent agenda.
Well, Mr. Chair?
Oh, we got a motion. Got a motion.
I'll support it.
Support, okay.
And then I would like to pull down number 31, please, the last one. Cancellation of contract for purchase of state tax corporate board letter 21-566.
Okay, where should we put that?
Environment.
Yeah, environment. There is no. Okay.
There is now.
Yes, right. We'll put that as number one under environment. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay, motion carries, thank you. Under our regular agenda, we'll go to Public Works and Transportation. Chair McDonald.
Thank you, Chair Jugovich. We have one item. We're getting this started. We're awarding bids for a culvert replacement project on some roads in my district. I would move it. Is there support?
Support.
Supported by Commissioner Nelson. And again, this is the culvert replacement project on County Road 912, CASA 115, and CASA 22, located in the Cook area. And if you just want to look, we were anxious to see what the bids were going to be like as we head into a new bidding year, and it came in under about almost 6%. So with that, I'll turn it over to administration to further frame it. And I know we have Director Faldesi on the line as well if we need any further information or anybody has any questions.
Thank you, Chair McDonald and Commissioners. The request before the board is to award to the apparent low bidder, KGM, a culvert replacement project on the several sites that were noted by Chair McDonald. The bid did come in below the engineer's estimate, the amount of approximately $413,000, so almost 6%. I would just add that this is the funding for this project. is a combination of state aid funds, local transportation sales tax, and local road levy dollars. So they're putting all the pieces to work on this, and it's good to get out of the chute and we'll see a lot more contracts early in the year as we continue our practice of bidding early as we can to ensure the best bids. And I think that's reflected here.
Thank you, Administrator Gray. Any questions, comments from commissioners? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. That motion is carried. Back to you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. We'll move on to finance and budget, where we have Chair Nelson.
Thank you, Chair Commissioner Yugovich. We do have several items under the Finance and Budget Committee for today. The first is American Rescue Plan Act funds promoting healthy childhood environments, and I would look for someone to move it.
I'll move it.
Moved by Commissioner Grimm. Is there support?
Support.
Supported by Commissioner McDonald.
Thank you, Chair Nelson. Commissioner Grimm has reached out to administration and constituents and is requesting that the board consider the use of $1 million of the available remaining American Rescue Plan Act funds to support investments in our youth across the county. I think it's probably best for me to turn the dialogue to her to talk about the background a little bit more, but we have worked to identify the key themes of promoting healthy childhood environments, addressing health disparities, and investing in housing. Those are things that continue to come forward. I know that she's received a lot of input on this as well. So this is a contemplated program and use of funds around parks, recreation, or other related programming that have an impact on children. Of course, as we talk about a conceptual program, all of this would also need to meet the eligibility guidelines, the Treasury guidance for any funding if the board chooses to support and make this set aside.
Thank you.
Over and above the framework already.
Thank you.
Commissioner
Grimm.
So I'll be moving this back to requesting to move this back to administration. I want to thank Commissioner McDonald. We had a good talk about hosting a workshop on this as well, so we can kind of work out some of the details together and get. And my hope is to get everybody on the same page. So, but just a little bit of background to this: the American Rescue Plan funds have a portion.
Commissioner Grimm.
Yeah.
I'm going to apologize, but. Yeah. If you're pulling it back, please don't say that first, okay? Because otherwise I'm going to stop you because you just pulled it off the table. So you're not pulling it back. You still want to discuss it further, right?
Yes.
Thank you, Commissioner Grimm.
So the background on this is to help promote healthy childhood environments. And a lot of this we already know is that we just passed a budget where we're working pretty downstream a lot of the time with kids and families. I saw that a lot with my work in the Damiano Center, but even being here in the city of Duluth, you can fill one school building full of students who are currently homeless right now. And so these are one-time funds where we could really build infrastructure for families. What Mark Bovin and a lot of our speakers spoke to earlier today about what's happening in Gary New Duluth, I took some notes on it. What really hit me is that when we invest in community infrastructure for families, you get increased enrollment, right? You hear about the changing of communities and it changes our kids' lives upstream. So administration and I worked together to make sure that areas throughout St. Louis County would qualify, because one other important thing about this is that a kid that's in Duluth is just as important as a kid that lives in greater St. Louis County. We are one county to our children. And by using just qualified census tracts, that would disproportionately give funds to Duluth. And so we pulled out a lot of other indicators like lack of broadband access, being further than 5 miles outside of your local grocery store. There's a whole list of indicators that we can use to really work as one county and allow each commissioner to work with your districts with the specific needs that you have to help build these projects, to help build things like Gary New Duluth Rec Center or spaces for childcare. I mean, those are just a few of the things that came up, as well as community garden programs and things that nonprofits and community groups have been trying to scrape by doing their bake sales, by raising $600,000, $2 million on their own, where we can invest these one-time funds and make a huge difference. And it also supplements our investment in the schools, because a large portion of Check and Connect is the Connect piece, right? And so this allows us to ramp up out-of-school services so that kids are able to connect to other things in our communities. And they would have to prove ongoing funding. So I'm incredibly excited to work with you all on this. I want to open it up to other commissioners to speak, and then I'll...
Thank you, Commissioner Grimm. If anyone else have anything further to add here, Commissioner Boyle.
Thank you, Chair. Commissioner Grimm, I think this is, I think you're on the right track on this, and I look forward to looking at this in the next 12 to 18 months. You know, first and foremost, on my where I want to keep these dollars close is we are nowhere near out of this pandemic. We are going to hit 800,000 deaths probably today or tomorrow in the country with a big wave of Omni coming through. So we're no way out of this yet. And I want to make sure we keep our public health whole for the next year and a half, 2 years. So that's the number one priority for me at this point. But that's not to say that not down the line, nothing set in stone, that we can't come back and look at this. And, I like the idea that district-wide, through our districts, to see what needs are there. I'm very happy that we put over $5 million into truancy to our school districts. And that is a three-year program that's working. I can't imagine how that's not going to be successful. So we have been thinking of our children. This would augment it. And like I say, under Chair McDonald's leadership next year, hopefully we can dig a little deeper.
That could be.
Thank you, Commissioner Boyle. Anything further, Commissioner McDonald?
Thank you, Chair Nelson. Again, in my tenure on the board and following the county board in previous years prior to my being in here, the mission of this board has always been about the kids, about the children. And I've seen that happen throughout my tenure, whether it be the Check and Connect, whether it be a project here with a field, or it's all about the kids. And I know that we will continue to move in that direction and do what we need to do to set the stage of the next generation. And we've got some unknowns out there, as Commissioner Boyle said. Hopefully, as we get into 2022, that we knock on wood, see some end at the end of this, and then we'll take it from there. But appreciate the feedback from everybody, and that's all I have, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner McDonald. Anything further, Commissioner
Graham? So I'll be looking for a workshop in the first quarter of 2022 in this, and excited to work with y'all. And with that, I'll pass it back to administration for one more time.
Thank you, Commissioner Graham. Thanks. With that, is it your intent at this point to withdraw the resolution?
Yes, that's what I mean. I'll withdraw the resolution and bring it back
to the supporter.
And I'm okay with
very
that.
Very good. The resolution has been withdrawn. We will move on. The second item under the Finance and Budget Committee today is Board Letter 21-569. This is adding an additional human resource advisor to a division that is already stressed to the nth degree, and I'm assured that this is a temporary position in the sense that we likely will have some movement within that department in the next year and a half to 2 years that will absorb this, but hopefully we can go from there. I will move it.
Support.
Is there support? Support by Commissioner McDonald, Kevin, I pretty much did that one, didn't I?
Well, I think
go ahead.
The fact is, you mentioned stressors, and I just want to really compliment this board for their awareness of, we talk about the organizational stress, and it's not unique to St. Louis County. It's to every business and small business owner and to people that are hustling for jobs, and it's been an extended stressful time. That said, human resources behind the scenes, much like public health, has been sorely tested as we've managed staff movements, different forms for identifying and recruiting and retaining and training staff. So this request is to acknowledge that. And while there are long-term plans that I think support this position, in the immediate to midterm, the funding would be solely to focus on the impacts of COVID along with the other workload issues that are so unique to HR at this point in time, including one of the things that's kind of slipped under the radar screen is on the merit system front, the additional workload that will entail as well. But I think with your permission, Mr. Chair, if Jim Gottschall could talk to it very briefly, I think he could really elaborate on why this is so important and how impactful this will be to supporting our departments and our employees.
Thank you, Administrator Gray. Director Gottschall, you already have 7 votes, so I'll just start you with that because I don't see anybody around this board disagreeing. But go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, Commissioner Nelson, Commissioners. So I don't want to overlook the fact that sometimes the longer you talk, the deeper the hole you dig. So thank you, Administrator Gray, for recognizing the sustained workload that not just human resources, but really all of our county departments have sustained. Our partners include safety and risk management and supervisors across this county. You know, I think initially when we got into the COVID pandemic, we really kind of saw this as a temporary thing. The longer we experience it, I think we recognize that it may just become our new norm in some ways. Over the years, HR has really expanded the services that we provide. Just last week at the AMC conference, the state demographer spoke to the challenges of today's workforce, where you have roughly 200,000 plus available jobs across the state, and you have fewer than 130,000 job seekers. And like any organization, we want to make sure that we are out there sourcing the best candidates to serve our citizens. And human resources really has kind of offered more specialized services. We no longer create eligible lists that we use for 12 months. We are literally recruiting for almost every vacancy that we have. And we work really closely with departments. And as we got into the COVID pandemic, in addition to the typical services that we provide with performance management and with training and technology support, self-service, so our employees can access all of their own information electronically. We've had to do things that we've never had to do before, like contact tracing with our workforce to identify potential exposures to make sure we protect our employees and by extension protect our citizens. We also do quite a bit with the interactive process associated with the Americans with Disabilities Act, as people are more scared of their situation, you know, whether they have an underlying health condition, their family members. We have to work through trying to identify accommodations in the workplace. In some instances, that has kind of followed the path of our mobile work policy that they may have to work from home. So there is a lot more that we do during a pandemic than we typically do. And that's really the basis. The sustained nature of the pandemic is really what's resulted in this ask. So I thank you so much for your favorable consideration of this request, and I'll stand for any questions.
Very good. Any questions at this point for Director Gottschall? No comments on the Christmas tie? I was pretty impressed, actually. Seeing no further comments, all those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion is carried. Thank you, Jim. The next is to renew an agreement for workers' compensation assistance from a third-party administrator. And I would move it as there's support, supported by Commissioner Yugovich. Before I turn this to Administrator Gray, I've been around long enough to remember when Joe Austin didn't do this for us. I got to tell you, we've come an awful long ways. Thank you, Joe, for everything you do over there, because it's made a difference for the county, for our workforce. Administrator Gray.
So, Chair Nelson, Commissioners, you stole my opening line. The action before the board is to renew an agreement that we entered into, I believe, 5 years ago, and with PMA companies for third-party administration portions of our workers' compensation program. At that time, it was a bold kind of new endeavor in leveraging and more cost-effectively and more efficiently manage our workers' compensation program that is under Joe Austin's purview as part of safety and risk management. And very briefly, Joe can highlight a couple of the reasons why we should continue to extend this, but I think it's been very clear that this has been a very positive experience, and short story is that we're seeking a renewal period for the next several years at an annual cost of approximately $117,000.
Very good. Joe, you got the Christmas tide directive too, right?
That's right. Atta Christmas tide.
Attaboy.
Chair Nelson, Commissioners, Joe Austin, Safety and Risk Management Director. As Kevin mentioned, the item before you is the renewal of an agreement for third-party assistance with select portions of our workers' comp management program. As you know, Safety and Risk implemented and manages a robust integrated claims management system focused on immediate response, expedited medical care and return to work, fair claims management, and cost containment. An important part of this process is our relationship with PMA for assistance with select portions of our self-insured, self-administered plan. Primarily, these consist of only two things: PMA's medical bill review services and the use of PMA's web-based Risk Information Management, or RIMIS, system that's called PMA Cinch. During the previous 2 years, we've saved roughly $1.2 million on the medical bill review alone. The RIMIS system included in the contract also enabled us to eliminate our previous system, which was called RiskMaster, which saved us $81,000 over the same time period. With the help of the Attorney's Office, we've negotiated an agreement with PMA for an extension of services identical in scope to those we've used for the past 5 years. The cost of these services, as Kevin mentioned, is $117,000 per year flat fee, plus a bill review fee at the same cost as our previous 7 years, which cannot exceed $30,000 per year. This is a total increase in $3,500 compared to our annual rate for the previous 2 year cycle. So I think it's a pretty fair contract. The agreement also gives us the option for extensions for the 2025 and 2026 years with a maximum increase of 3% per year on that flat fee, and all the fees associated with the bill review remaining the same. So as pointed out in the board letter, our partnership with PMA over the last 5 years has been an important part of our robust workers' comp management program that has resulted in considerable cost savings to St. Louis County. What we're asking the board to vote on is to potentially renew this agreement so that St. Louis County can continue to experience these savings. And after that, I'll stand for questions.
Thank you, Director Austin. The fact that we have gone a few days past the thing, that does not impact us at all, Jim or Joe?
Commissioner Nelson, Commissioners, that has no impact at all. I've negotiated already.
I noticed that we're beyond the date. That's why I'm asking.
Yep.
Questions, concerns from commissioners? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by the sign aye.
Aye.
All the same sign. Thank you, Joe. We have one other item, Mr. Chair, under the Finance and Budget Committee. It's paying pandemic relief to congressionally chartered veteran organizations. Moved by Commissioner McDonald, supported by Commissioner Yugovich. Administrator Gray.
Thank you, Chair Nelson. The goal of this resolution is to provide some pandemic relief to veterans service organizations that own and actually pay property taxes within St. Louis County. And the a path to that is to approve expenditures related to real property ownership through the use of ARPA monies, given the constraints and the impacts to these organizations that in the delivery of their services and opportunities to our veterans. I'll let Commissioner or Chair Nelson talk to this more, but I would just highlight that, of course, these veteran organizations, of which there are, I believe, seven throughout the county, including VFWs and Legions as two examples, are primarily there to serve veterans and to support them through their membership and services on-site locally and nationally, and really that their whole purview is to provide that setting and for our veterans. So the action before the board is to direct administration to look to the process for whereby this these organizations may apply for ARPA funds to offset those financial impacts due to the pandemic and continue to serve our veteran community in the best fashion they can.
Very good. Thank you, Administrator Gray. These organizations are throughout St. Louis County, and much like all of the other hospitality industry-based organizations, certainly it's been a struggle for them during this pandemic. Any questions, concerns? Commissioner Joel.
So, for administration, were they eligible for any of the pandemic relief already?
I'll
Deputy
turn
Director,
it over to Deputy Mr. Fritzinger.
Deputy Director Fritzinger. Deputy Administrator.
Chair Nelson, Commissioners, Commissioner Jewell, under the CARES Act, the program that was designed to assist local businesses was also designed to assist local nonprofits as well. And they would have qualified under that program, phases one and probably phase two. I do not know, though, however, if any of these establishments actually applied for or received any funding through those two programs.
Deputy Administrator Fritzinger, I'm gonna respond to that because I, having talked closely with the Deputy Commander of the VFWs and Legions up here, they were notified by their statewide agencies roughly 30 days after all of that closed. So no, they I think maybe one that I know of was able to access anything, but the truth is they were notified 30 days after all of the application process closed. And Matt Johnson is not here right now, but if he were, he would tell you that we tried for several of them. This only gives them the ability to go up to the amount of property taxes they pay at the county level. It's not refunding or doing anything else. It's just up to that county property tax level to show them that basically that this board cares about keeping those organizations out there. We've had a number of them close. I think almost every commissioner knows of one or two that have closed. This would try and salvage those 7 to 10 that are left. And that's really it. And it's like not even $10,000 at the end of the day. Commissioner Joel.
So I'm not opposed to this, and it doesn't seem like a lot of money. I will say that this we were forewarned about this years ago in the book Bowling Alone, that people are moving away from these kinds of organizations and not investing in them. And as sad as it may be, the Vietnam vets and the vets from Iraq and so on aren't joining organizations like this. And I think it's positive that we support them, and knowing that the environment has changed and they may not survive, as hard as that is. And it's certainly true in the place I came from. You know, they just they haven't made it across the finish line. And that's sad, and I don't know if I'm not sure that up to $10,000 will change that, but it's worth trying.
Thank you, Commissioner Jewell. It's it truly is more of a vote of confidence in the fact that we'd like them to stick around. I will point out, you know, when I started on this board, we had 22,000 veterans in St. Louis County. 22,000 retired veterans. That number went all the way down to about 14,000.
Yeah.
But that number right now is just under 18,000. So we've had a bit of a renaissance in those numbers. When you look around and you've picked up 4,000 veterans, well, that's a bunch. And part of that is credit to our VSOs and the hard work they're doing out in the communities. Again, this is just a pat on the back and telling them that we want them to stick around. If they feel value in this organization, we also see it. That's really the message. Thank you, Commissioner Jewell. Commissioner Graham.
Yeah, I just want to thank Commissioner Nelson for bringing this up. I think it's a good investment. I, in processing through this, I talked to one of my friends who serves and works at the 148th, and she's I think younger than me. I think she's 33, and just really hit home how even amongst her and her friends, like, those are utilized as community spaces and the ways to talk intergenerationally too about, like, the shared experience and how important it is in the community. So I really support these funds going towards investments like this. And looking forward to doing it.
Thank you, Commissioner Graham. Commissioner McDonald.
Thank you, Chair Nelson. Again, I would speak highly in favor of this. And, you know, when you look at a place where vets can talk to veterans, I mean, you know, it's a place where they can handle some of their issues and talk to somebody that has been where they have been. And I think that's something that goes even beyond what we're talking about here. In a lot of the places, VFWs and Legions in my district, they're hanging by a shoestring. I mean, you know, a little bit here and a little bit there. I know I talked to some of the groups, and they're looking at trying to do some outreach to get some more members, get some younger members. I know in Ely, for instance, you know, trying to get some younger members involved with the Honor Guard through the Legion and do some of those things. So I think there's an opportunity there. It is a very, very warm goodwill gesture on behalf of this board to do that. And I look forward to seeing some positive results out of it.
Thank you, Commissioner McDonald. Deputy Administrator Fritzinger.
Chair Nelson, commissioners, just two items for clarity and one question for clarification that staff would look for from the board as well. We are talking, again, as Commissioner Nelson indicated, it's actually 15 different establishments that would be affected by this, all under a 315 classification code as designed under state law. About $7,300 would be the county's share annually for that. So those are just the two clarification points from my side. And then the third point for clarification as you take the action is, whether we're talking about a 1 year, a 2 year, or a 3 year, kind of being that we're talking about the use of ARPA funds, we do have time frame there. So I just want to make sure we're all on the same page with the expectation related to that.
Very good. And I apologize, I was a little bit under on the number of organizations and a little bit over on the amount that it's going to cost St. Louis County. But we had tried figuring it out, and we had come up with around 10. And that was, so if there are 15, that's great, that if there's 15 that have come in. Seeing no further discussion, all those in favor signify by the sign aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. The motion is carried. Mr. Chair, that is all I have under the Finance and Budget Committee for today.
Thank you. We'll go to Central Management Intergovernmental. Chair Jewell.
Thank you, Chair Jewell. We have several items under my committee. The first of these is the appointment of St. Louis County UOCAVA ballot board appointments. But that's it. And then if you have to say the whole line, actually, it's even worse.
So, but, and this is related to overseas citizen, uniform and overseas citizen absentee voting act, and we have to appoint people, all of whom I think work for the auditor's office. They are Jonathan Blevins, Brenda George, and Joe Deanna. I would move it. Is there a second?
Support. I was looking, Mr. Chair.
Well, we've got it. It's late, and we ate lunch, so you know. So okay, I look to administration.
Thank you, Chair Jewell, Commissioners. Each election cycle, we do look for these appointments to be approved by the board. This is a very critical role in the process. I want to especially acknowledge not only the auditor, but Clerk Chapman, who is integral to the election process. And if you think some people are putting in long hours with lots of people looking over their shoulder, should have been hanging with Phil and his team during the last election cycle, national cycle. These appointments are very critical to ensuring consistency and uniformity in the absentee ballot process. And these judges, if you will, have that ability to accept or reject absentee ballots. Make sure that's in accordance with the standards that have been prescribed to them. So the three individuals are, as were identified by Chair Jewell, employees of the St. Louis County's Auditor's Office, will serve as the 2022 Uniform and Overseas Citizen Absentee Voting Aid Ballot Board.
So, is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Motion carries. Next item is reappointments to the Cooperative Extension Committee of Jim Takala and Rick Pierce. Do I have a motion?
I'll move this.
Made by Commissioner
Barton.
I'll second.
No, go ahead.
I didn't see you.
Don't worry about it.
The two of us serve with these guys, so. So I would say that one of the things, COVID has been a little hard on the extension committee and trying to meet and so on, but the group, we now have a new regional coordinator for extension, and we're beginning to meet again. Rick and particularly Jim Shackla have been amazing partners on this committee. Jim is now in his third term, I think, as chair. And does a great job, and obviously while also running a farm up north, he retired as a school teacher. Interesting, Rick Pierce also was a school teacher, retired. Now he cleans chimneys, I think, which is a great, and raises his lamb. So both of them perfect for such a thing. And I don't think you can do better than that.
Chair Jewell, no, I can't, other than to reinforce it's for a three-year term for both of these individuals, renewing that term, and to say that in future resume submissions, I will note chimney sweeps as part of a critical skill set to highlight.
Jim told me, which is an interesting thing, he has more work than he has ever had before during the pandemic because of all the people moving to their cabins and needing their chimneys to work. So he was like wildly busy. Okay, so all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. The third item is a resolution to authorize the certificate of possessory title to real estate in St. Louis County. You'll move it?
Mr. Chair, no, I would like to send it back to administration if we could. We have 6 months on this, and as I read through this, look, this is a fairly significant change to how we manage real estate, real estate proper, or real estate transactions. And I would like, would very much like for our county attorney to weigh in with the legal community and see and get some input on this, because I worry that we're getting ahead of them a little bit here. And given the amount of time we have to enact it, I want to make sure that our legal community has time to weigh in on what I see as, you know, it's basically abstract versus Torrance titles. But again, it's a fairly significant change. So I'm just hoping we can delay it until we have an opportunity to vet it a little bit more.
I have to say that when I read it, I was immediately thought to call my friend Dave Adams, the former recorder, to say, "Hey, what would you say about this?" And my guess is I know its answer. Administrator Gray.
So Chair Jewell, this is not, it's time sensitive, but not days or hours, months. I will tell you that I had the opportunity to spend some time with the current examiner of titles, Kim Brzezinski, who has done an outstanding job and been a great examiner of titles for us. So she's leaving the role to return to private practice. This has her wholehearted endorsement, and but I appreciate wanting to understand a little bit more the legal terminology, the opportunity to work with the attorney's office, and we're very supportive of that discussion. But in the end, this will simplify the process for a title that is not in question or not being contended. Will help streamline the process and raise a number of efficiencies that way. And I think that that's what will come of this. I know that Director Garnas is on the line as well. But if the board's desires to send it back to administration, have a little more dialogue with the attorney's office, I'm sure Director Garnas would be willing to have that discussion and maybe a chance to individually just clarify some of the complex terms that in the end is a change that I believe almost all entities, certainly our size, are already have moved to towards and will in the end help accelerate the process for land titles handling that is not being contested. I don't know if Director Carnes has any other comments to that effect, but we can certainly have that return and
Director Garnas, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity to discuss this topic on the agenda. I can certainly provide a summary of the benefits of a CPT. It's allowed by Chapter 508A. I'm prepared to talk about the use of a CPT, the benefits, the process that we would put in place, and any cost concerns. So I can do that now, or if there's a need to provide additional opportunity for conversation, I would be okay with that as well. So I guess whatever the county board is wanting at this point. So I can go ahead with my summary, or
I think Director Garnas, I think it makes sense to send it back to administration for a bit and get some feedback, and then have your presentation at another meeting, if that would be possible.
Yeah, that's certainly possible. If there's any specific questions that the board has, if you wanna, you know, drop me an email, just give me a phone call. I can help to clarify. And then the memo that was provided to the board hopefully helps spell out in some level of detail what the process would entail, but I would be happy to provide more detail or spend more time on a presentation if need be. But I will say that Kim Brzezinski, the current examiner, appreciate all of her work with the county. She will be leaving us though on December 27th. And we do have a new examiner that actually started with the recorder's office today. So we thought it was a good opportunity to have this conversation before Kim departs. But I'd be happy to discuss further at a later date.
Okay, great. Anything else, Commissioner Nelson?
Oh, Mr. Chair, if we can just delay it some, I look, I'm certainly not an expert in this field, but I know a number of people who are, and it's difficult when this stuff comes in front of you and you're asked to pass it board committee board. It just felt like the bum's rush on something that I think is really, really critical as we look forward. And I would like to see a fact sheet from the director's office. Perhaps she could put together a fact sheet, but I certainly want to reach out to our real estate attorneys. They're the ones that I'm worried about here, because the truth is that's becoming a little bit of a lost art too. Okay. And I want to make sure that we're recognizing their efforts here in this county and certainly appreciating their opinion on this before we move forward. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Okay. I saw a signal from Administrator Gray that sending it back is an appropriate move at the moment, I think. So we will do that, and at a meeting in January, hopefully we'll be able to pass this forward. Okay. Next, we heard a great presentation on this at the Association of Minnesota Counties. This is the settlements with opioid distributors, McKesson, Cardinal Health, Amaris, Bergen, and opioid manufacturer Johnson & Johnson related matters. I would move it. Is there a second? We're supported by Commissioner Boyle. I'd look to administration.
Thank you, Chair Jewell, and I will frame it briefly, but with your indulgence, I would ask that Assistant County Attorney Campanario also fill in the board. He's been on point for this and has done an incredible job. The action before the board is a request to approve the settlement with the distributors and Johnson & Johnson for the opioid settlement, the proposed settlement, which I believe is in excess of $26 billion between all the parties, the distributors and Johnson & Johnson itself. There has been a bunch of work that has been done by, I presume, at the city level, but certainly at the county level. AMC has been a huge coordinating point along with the individual entities. It's a requirement that we approve this to participate in the settlement, at least as outlined today, and that it's a time-sensitive notice of that vote by the board. So I'll turn it over to Attorney Campanario, but I would also like to just highlight that this has been a real quick time frame to ensure that the allocation of these proceeds do go to the parties that need it the most. And I think the final package does reflect, and we'll hear more from Nick, a 75-25 allocation, 75% going to counties and I believe some large cities. But the work behind that, working with the Attorney General's office, Director Mersch was a part of a small team that was directly interacting with the Attorney General's office, and that committee helped inform the decision. And she did a tremendous amount of work in a short period of time and contributed to what I think is a very positive outcome with respect to this settlement. So I just wanted to acknowledge that as well. So with your permission, I turn it over to Assistant County Attorney Campanario.
Good afternoon. We do have a number of related matters to discuss around the opioid settlements. The first of which is the nationwide settlement with McKesson, Cardinal Health, and AmerisourceBergen. These are drug distributors. They're commonly referred to as the Big Three distributors, and there's good reason for that. Together, they've got almost all of the U.S. market share when it comes to drug distribution. The settlement with them calls for them to pay up to $21 billion in total over 18 years. It also puts in place certain changes with regard to their business practices. And included within that is the creation of a new clearinghouse that will involve distributors keeping track of their shipments. And the point of that is to try to help to detect, stop, and report suspicious opioid orders over time so that we can do a better job in that area. There is a separate nationwide settlement with Johnson & Johnson, which manufactured certain opioids products through one of its subsidiaries, Janssen. And that settlement calls for Johnson & Johnson to pay up to $5 billion over 9 years. And that also includes certain relief with respect to their business practices. And in that regard, they're going to agree not to market or sell any opioid products for the next 10 years. They're also going to agree not to engage in any lobbying about prescription opioids for the next 10 years. And they're going to make available for research purposes a lot of the data that they generated over the years with respect to their opioids trials. When you put those two together on a combined basis, we're talking up to $26 billion. Minnesota's share of that pot is up to $300 million, or potentially above that. I say up to $300 million because the precise amount is going to depend on how many local governments within the state sign on to the settlements. As with any settlement, what the defendants are getting out of it is releases of claims. The more local governments that step forward and sign on and release their claims, the more the defendants are willing to pay. So we will not know the precise amount until we get through this period for local governments to decide whether to sign on. And as of right now, that period expires on January 2nd, which is why we have the need to take action today. In connection with those nationwide settlements, local governments worked with the state to try to figure out how is that money going to be allocated between local governments on one hand and the state on the other, and also to work out what are the approved purposes for which those funds can be used. With regard to the allocation, what we ended up with was a 75% split for local governments and a 25% split that will go to the state. I am told that in one state, local governments were able to achieve 80%. With that exception, this is the best split that local governments have achieved anywhere. So it is favorable in that regard. Another thing I want to mention about the split is that under current state law, there's a statute that directs how opioid settlement proceeds are to be handled. Under that law, we can't do a 75-25 split. So in order to implement this aspect of the deal, the state and the local governments have agreed to seek a legislative change to amend that statute to allow for the 75-25. If we can't achieve that for some reason, then there is a backup, which involves a 60% to the local governments, 40% to the state split. That is permitted under current law, and that's what would happen if we can't get the amendment. With regard to St. Louis County's share, so you've got the 75% coming to local governments. Our share of that as a percentage is approximately 4.74%. Couple points about that. That is the fifth highest percentage of any local government in the state. We are behind Hennepin County, Ramsey County, Anoka County, and City of Minneapolis, and that becomes us. Based on the way those percentages were determined and the formula that was used to come up with those, we were able to punch above our at least population weight in terms of how that was developed. So that was more good news. If you translate the percentage into amount, we've got to make some assumptions here. If you assume Minnesota's overall recovery is $300 million, and you assume that we're able to get the legislative amendment that will allow the 75-25 split, then you're talking approximately $10.7 million. That would be the county share. As I mentioned, the agreement between the states and the local governments also addresses approved purposes. There was an advisory panel that was put together to work on that issue. Linnea Mersch was a key member of that panel. And what they came up with was a list of 13 categories of things that you can spend the money on. All of them, of course, are related to addressing the opioid crisis. None of the money will be diverted to any other purpose. That's the set of interrelated agreements in a nutshell. What we're asking the board to do is, one, approve entering into the nationwide settlements with the distributors and Johnson & Johnson. Again, that's the thing that has to happen by January 2nd. To approve our entry into the agreement with the state that provides for the 75-25 and sets out the approved purposes. And then three, expresses support for an amendment to the state statute that will allow us to implement the 75-25 split. Are there any questions?
So, Nick, one question. I mean, I assume, and maybe this is wrong, that the $10 million then is divided by 18 years, or do we get the $10 million up?
You don't get the 10 or whatever it turns out to be up front.
Yeah, right.
It will come in chunks over time.
Okay.
Yep.
So given the size of the problem, it's a very small speck in the of health. Okay, other Commissioner Nelson.
Mr. Chair, just a couple of comments. First of all, how damn much money did these people make selling opioids? It just insanity. But what we've seen happen in this country. But my point of concern is this: look, we're how many months into this? It's up in front of us now. We have to do it right now. And we have our hands out to the state saying, oh please, would you allow us to be 75-25 instead of 60-40? My experience with the state, when it comes to money, if you put a $100 bill in front of you in the state of Minnesota, they're going to grab it first. So I'm concerned about that. I'm also concerned, and quite frankly, we have nothing to say about it, but I'm also concerned that they're going to pigeonhole us and make us spend it on things that maybe our Health and Human Services director and others would say is not going to be as effective in St. Louis County as other things. And that's just a habit that they have. But I want to thank Linnea and her team for everything they've done on this, and also Nick for all your hard work on it. I mean, it's money that we're getting, but the truth is it can't even touch the problem, as Commissioner Jewell stated. This is a balloon in a big north breeze. And quite frankly, we're just not, you know, the effects that the societal effects that this has had, we can't even begin to touch with 10 times that money. So you can feel good about it, but the truth is we should feel bad about it, because at the end of the day, that's where we're at. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Other comments, questions? Commissioner Boyle.
Again, thank you, Nick, for your work on this, and Director Mersch, too. You did yeoman's work on this. I, at the point, I remember when Attorney Rubin brought this to us to begin with, the thought was this could take 10, 15 years in litigation to finally come up with approval. I think this came quicker than we thought it would, but with that process, I think it's less dollars attached to it than you probably thought it was, compared to what we got with big tobacco. And everybody has been here long enough understands what's happened. Opiates were so addictive and were hidden on their how addictive they were to the medical community that it was the only drug to this day that hit socioeconomic classes all the same, males, females, all the same. And absolutely who got hit the hardest on this was counties. There's no doubt in my mind what we had to go through over the last decade and a half. You're looking at public health, social services. You're looking at out-of-home places, both because of this. Jail, incarnations, deaths. destroying families. It just boggles my mind how intense this was and how hidden it was on how addictive this medication was that was being prescribed at the time. That being said, you got to look at it as still a win. It's something that we got. It might be just a slap on the hands, but you know, looking forward to sitting down with some of the community leaders on this front to come up with a really solid game plan how we use these dollars moving forward for the next decade and helping those individuals that are struggling with it and keeping them better. So thank you.
Commissioner Nelson.
Thank you, Chair. Commissioner Jewell. Nick, are there any efforts to hold the medical community responsible on any of this? I mean, these prescriptions didn't leap out of the pill bottle and into people's hands. Or is that something that's being discussed anyplace?
To date, I haven't seen any lawsuits against either hospitals or clinic organizations or individual doctors. No.
Does this lawsuit make them immune?
No, it doesn't make them
There's
immune.
There's no immunity for them.
No, no. There's not. And going back, is it enough money? Certainly not. It's helpful. Is it anywhere close to enough to address the scope of the problem at hand? Absolutely not. I do want to remind though that this is the three distributors and Johnson & Johnson. So that's one piece of the puzzle. We've got that. We've got the separate bankruptcy involving Purdue. That we've talked about before. We've got the additional bankruptcy involving Mallinckrodt that we've talked about before. And then we've got additional defendants who aren't part of these settlements and haven't filed for bankruptcy. And our case against them will still go forward. I say go forward. It's still bottled up in Cleveland with all the thousands of other local government suits, but those will still remain alive. And so this isn't it.
So, Mr. Chair,
yes.
If we can, I would like us in these meetings to ask the question where the medical community is. Because I know with a high degree of certainty, we had providers in St. Louis County that were just known as, if you want opioids, you go here. And I mean, I can name four or five of them, which I'm not going to do, but I mean, there has to be some accountability there as well. And I'd at least like the question asked, okay? It's probably going to be no, but I'd at least like to ask the question because there were no lily whites in this whole deal. Everybody knew what was going on.
Okay. Commissioner McDonald.
Thank you, Chair Jewell. Again, you just look at the per capita rates of problems we've had in St. Louis County with opioids. And, it's nice to be fifth in line to get a larger pot of money, but what it says is we've got an issue. And we all know we have an issue. I'm just hoping we can, with Director Mersch and her team, also with some experts that we have throughout St. Louis County, that we can sit down and come up with some strategies, hopefully some new strategies, maybe some best practices from other places in the country and put a decent program together to help these families in St. Louis County who've been affected by opioid issues. And again, Nick, thank you for all you've done on this as well and your team. But, we've got some work ahead here, and hopefully we can make some progress. As Commissioner Boyle said, it's not a lot of money, but it's still some money where hopefully we can get some things going that are going to help alleviate some of this stuff down the line. So, thanks again.
Any other comments? I will say that the presentation that AMC did suggest that one of the things that got us where we are, even if it's not as good as it should be, is that it was collaborative across every county in the the state. And really, that's impactful when everybody says this problem and it ought to be dealt with. So it's not great, but it is a start. So, okay, hearing no other comments, all those in favor?
Aye.
Those opposed? Motion carries. Next item on my agenda is the withdrawal from the Carlton Cook Lake St. Louis Community Health Board. Does somebody want to move it?
I would move it, Mr. Chair.
For a second. Seconded by Commissioner Jugovich. Go ahead, administration.
Thank you, Chair Jewell. Commissioners, this resolution is being brought forward in this request from Commissioner Nelson to consider the county's withdrawal from the Community Health Board partnership with Carlton, Cook Lake, and of course St. Louis counties. This partnership has been in place and is a primary source for the funding of grants and revenues to the local public health authorities. The agreement has been in place since 1997 and was amended approximately a decade ago. The board letter goes into some detail talking about the timing and impact of withdrawing from the Community Health Board, including the requirement that we have an advance notice of 1 year, which has to be in place, obviously, before January 1st of this year, for the effective date to be effective the following year after, in this case, January of 2023. There has been some discussion, and I will certainly defer to Commissioner Nelson as to his perspective and background on this. But a study of the CHB or the Community Health Board and other options to maybe include looking at it further through the joint, extending the Joint Powers Committee or other things have been brought up. But there are a number of kind of prescriptive issues that go along with this. Director Mersch is here to talk to the impacts of the withdrawal, just in the interest of a full disclosure, including the requirements around funding agreements to be effectively revisited. Quite a bit of significant effort would go underway both internally and externally if the board concludes to go in this direction. And that's the background that we have. And again, I would note that Director Mersch is here. So should the board, after this discussion, conclude to withdraw from the Community Health Board partnership, joint powers arrangement, a resolution is attached that does give that direction to approve the notification to the Commissioner of Health in that regard.
Commissioner Nelson.
Thank you, Chair Commissioner Jewell. Look, most of us around this board know that if this had come in front of us 2 years ago, it would have been a slam dunk vote to get out. And the fact of the matter is that it never came to the board. It should have. And that part of it concerns me. It's one of the reasons I'm bringing it up at this point. But folks, we get in these relationships with our friends and neighbors, and I am not always sure that the taxpayers I represent are well served by these relationships. And it really concerns me because for many, many years, I talked about St. Louis County always being the benevolent big brother. And some of these organizations that they concern me. I personally don't know that much about the Community Health Board. I have never been a member of it, but I've heard from members of it. And I get concerned that my taxpayers, the people that are putting the funds in there, are not the ones being served, that we're serving other counties.
For years, commissioners, I have sat and took the ire of many on this board for talking about Arrowhead Regional Corrections. I'm going to quote Commissioner Forsman. And I think those of you that have served with him know exactly what the quote is. I told you so. I told you so. So I sit here today in a couple of relationships with our friends to the west that are concerning me greatly. How many dollars am I taking from my constituents, and pouring into organizations that we, St. Louis County, could do a better job of serving those people? And that's my big concern here, folks. And again, had this been brought to us a few years ago, my understanding is now that we have new people, it's working better, but the question is how long? I don't want to be unreasonable, but I've been asking for this to be in front of the board, Administrator Gray, for at least the last 2.5 months. Here I find myself on the last day, and quite frankly, I would probably tell anyone else that they're unreasonable for bringing it here to last day, because I would think they would be. I didn't bring it here the last day. I wanted it here 2.5 months ago. I have vowed at this position to never, ever question Director Mersch. That's based on working with her for a lot of years. She was very young when she started with us, by the way. Look, I don't have any heartburn over withdrawing this, and that's what I will do here in just a second. If we do a study over the course of this next year, in fact, no, not year, because otherwise I'm going to hit the last 3 months and I'm going to have an administrator try to talk me out of it. 9 months. 9 months. To prove to me that this community health board is effective, not for the whole region, but for my community, the people that I represent, because I don't represent people in Carleton County, nor do I represent people in Lake County or Cooch or Cook, but I don't want to be the one funding these things and then my taxpayers being shortchanged here as they have been at ARC since the beginning of time when I came on this board. And it seems like the beginning of time, Commissioner Jewell. I'm sorry, but it does kind of seem like the beginning of time. So with that, I'm going to withdraw my motion. With the understanding, Chair Commissioner McDonald, as you chair next year, can we make sure that this is something that gets looked at in that first 9 months so that we can bring something back here that is meaningful?
Commissioner Nelson, rest of the board, I think it's a viable argument to look at it. And I mean, we have, right now, we have the group, the Joint Powers Group. I know ARC will be on the docket early in 2022. And looking at, what we can accomplish with this Joint Powers Board, I think it's a logical way to go through that committee and take a look at exactly what we're looking at, how it's working in conjunction with Director Mersch and the committee, take a look at this and then report back to the board at some time later in 22.
I'm going to recognize Commissioner Boyle.
Thank you, Chair. And, thank you, and I know Director Mersch is here. I don't know if she wants to speak or not, but I challenge anybody that hasn't been on this board, if they want to take my seat next year, please do, because I think you learn so much more when you're, in that organization to see how it works. And coming from a healthcare background, and there's no doubt that there was some disagreements between CHB and I think the leadership with St. Louis County, and we went through that, we debated it internally. There was a change with director, with Community Health Board. The relationship has gotten a lot better. And guess what else happened? We just hit a pandemic. My argument always has been that public health doesn't have county borders. And especially in the Arrowhead region, we are the medical provider. I don't care if it's something that happens in Grand Marais, Cloquet, International Falls. If it's something bad, they're coming to us. And community board, in its most part, is preventive care. It's getting in front of an issue before it happens. And I just really respect the leadership that's come out of the Community Health Board over the last couple of years. I think it's gotten a lot healthier. I have no problem, with Chair-elect McDonald to go over this with our subcommittee, but I brought this up to Commissioner Nelson, is that Director Mersch and Amy Westbrook have so much on their plate right now during this pandemic. I don't want to put this kind of load on her and Amy right now, out of my two cents on this. We can look at it a little bit for Commissioner Nelson, but I'm not going to kill him on this one because we have a lot more fish to fry than this issue during a pandemic. Like I say, we're at the average of 1,200 people dying every day. We're going to hit 800,000 today or tomorrow. It's not going away, folks. And I need Amy and Lene to be doing the number one job with public health and hitting this pandemic. We are the leaders at that front of local government. So I have no problem, but I want to be very cautious on Director Mersch's time and Amy Westbrook's time on this one. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, hearing my fellow commissioners' comments again, I withdraw my motion at this point.
I will recognize you after I
recognize
anybody else who wishes to speak to this.
Sorry, Mr. Chair.
So the thing I would add to this, I have now served since Mike Forsman went off this board, I think, when he left when he retired. Clearly, there were some issues that needed to be cleaned up. I think those, in part, were changed dramatically by the hiring of a new executive director. I would say that, like Commissioner Boyle, I am happy that any of the rest of you are the members who are appointed to it. I have done my duty on it and would love to, if somebody else got the sense of the needs and important activities that are taking place and related to opioids, to smoking, to drinking, to the prevention of health issues more generally in this region and the impact that, and I would say this, in some ways, it's less about the organization and more about the collaboration and the work of all of these health and human service groups in this region. I mean, we do amazing work in our health and human services here at St. Louis County, and they do amazing work in Carleton and also in Lake and Cook, even though they're tiny. And you only really learn about that being part of it. So I'm happy to pass it on to one of you to do that and to learn those things that are going on. But I feel like this is not the time to dump a positive working group. And it's really not the time in the middle, still the middle of the pandemic. As people know, many of our hospital ICUs are still full.
And it's really challenging to the medical professionals who are working, including our public health nurses and human service staff working. So I don't favor jumping in and looking at this, but I do favor any of you who want to raise your hand joining the committee and participating as a member. I will support that at the meeting on the 4th. Anything else? Hearing nothing, Commissioner Nelson, you wish to...
Mr. Chair, you've almost talked me out of withdrawing it at this point, but look, there's only one reason that I'm willing to withdraw it at this point, and that's Director Murray. And let's make no bones about it. As far as the other counties around us, we need to hold them accountable, period. Not just in this board, but in every other aspect that we deal with them. So at that, I will withdraw.
Right. Thank you. And with that, it's back to you, Chair Jurkovich.
Thank you very much. We'll move on to Environment and Natural Resources. Mr. Russo.
Thank you, Chair. One item here pulled down, Board Letter 21-566. It's the cancellation of a contract for the purchase of state tax forfeit land. I would move this if there's support. Support by Boyle. Administration.
Thank you, Chair Musoff and Commissioners. The action before the board is a request to cancel a contract for purchase that was executed last year with the purchaser, a James E. Donahue of Breckenridge, Michigan, for failure to comply with the terms of the repurchase agreement. Director Marinucci is here if there are any questions, or do you want to add a little bit of context to this? Again, this was discussed at some length approximately a year ago at this board.
Director, please.
All right.
Chair Musoff, I don't believe anyone moved the resolution.
I moved it. Boyle seconded.
Oh, sorry. I didn't catch it. I apologize.
Go ahead, Director.
Thank you, Chair. Commissioners, a little bit of background on this. You did approve the repurchase back last fall. And as part of that repurchase, there was terms and conditions for code compliance and remediation of blighted conditions. Those terms and conditions were not met within the 60 days that were part of the arrangement. But due to the pandemic and the eviction moratorium, we had to hold on cancellation and eviction on this property. Due to that, that has now been lifted, and we've thoughtfully moved through the process, now moving it forward for cancellation. So the affected parties have been noticed as required by statute, and they have expressed concerns about it, but it's been very clear both from our standpoint on those terms and conditions and from the city of Winton's perspective that the terms and conditions have not been met, and we would recommend cancellation of the contract, and then it would move forward through the eviction process.
Okay. Thank you, Director Marinucci. Comments?
Mr. Chair.
Commissioner Nelson.
Thank you, Chair. Commissioner Musoff. Look, we need to continue to work on cleaning up a lot of these, in this case, tax forfeited property that's still being occupied. But look, these properties are affecting their neighbors, and that's the bottom line. And they're adversely affecting their neighbors, and some of them have put up with this stuff for a lot of years. And I'm sorry, it's starting to look like Appalachia out there in certain spots. This is stuff that we need to do. And I've consistently urged our new land commissioner to, wherever we have opportunities to clean up this type of blighted situation, we need to act as quickly as possible and do the best we possibly can. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner Nelson. Further comments, questions? Commissioner McDonald.
Thank you, Chair Musoff. Again, this has been something that's been hanging on for quite a while here, and
I know I've talked to Director Marinucci about these cancellation contracts, you know, and being on the consent agenda, and more than likely we'd like to move those to the regular agenda as they come up. And again, this starts the process. Is there a way for them to get out of that? I believe there's an avenue to do that. You know, these kind of things, as we all know, pull at your heartstrings. I mean, and they're difficult, but, you know, there comes a time and a place. This has been elongated because of the pandemic. And, you know, at the 11th hour, we get something. So, you know, I would move forward with it.
Any other comments, questions?
Thank you, Commissioner.
It's late. It really is late.
I'll echo it, though. Any further questions, comments? Seeing none, I do agree with that as well, that move forward with some of these issues. But all those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Nays? Ayes have it. Motion passes. Back to you, Chair.
Thank you. Commissioner, discussion items and reports.
Mr. Chair, I have a couple of quick things. First, I'd like to take just a moment to thank you, Mr. Chair. I said this at the end of last year and the beginning of this year. I believe you served as chair in probably the most difficult time that I can recall.
I'm not done yet.
Certainly in my tenure on the board. And I know you're not done yet. There's a few days left. But Mr. Chair, at least from this commissioner's seat, I truly appreciate the work that you've done, kind of hanging in there and keeping us all moving forward through some very interesting times. Okay, so... But with that, I want to turn to one other item, and this is a human interest item. I'm going to take this down because I need to. Mr. Chair, as you know, I take the only time of the year that I take any time off is during the deer hunting season, okay? And it's something that my family and I very much enjoy. But this year I was sitting in a old deer shack that was from 1952, and I was sitting in that shack and I was reminded of something that I hadn't really paid attention to for a long, long time, and it was a poem written on the wall, and it's written in pencil on cardboard. The cardboard is the insulation on the insides of the walls. And it was written there by the son of a Finnish immigrant to this country. And as a Finnish immigrant to this country, Heikki Sauko, which would be my bride's grandfather, was subjected to what was termed at the time blackballing by the mines. And he was blackballed not because of the color of his skin. He was blackballed because of the courage of his convictions, which were safer work environment, better pay for the workers, organizing, okay? And those of us who've lived on the range, we all know that this is part of our history. Well, and it's not a pretty part of our history, but it is part of our history. But he wrote a poem on the wall there, from the son of someone who was treated that badly, okay? And it's a simple little poem, so. His name ain't on no tablet, and no park his statue stands. All his life he grubbed for wages,
You could tell it by his hands. Mr. Chair, please read the last two. Yes, I apologize. It's...
The wealth he left behind him wouldn't fill a sardine can, but I'd like to got to thank him for just being my old man. Very nice.
And that's it.
Very nice. Did it.
It was, those were the words of Oliver, Ole Selko, but it's, you gotta know the history and how much emotion he put into that. It's simple, but wow, you know, you could tell it by his hands. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Chair Jukovich. So I just want to say this out loud at this meeting, as opposed to the first meeting of the year. Last year, at the first meeting of the year, we suddenly nominated you, and you got a second year as chair. We nominated, Commissioner McDonald was nominated, and was also elected as vice chair, and will be chair this coming year. That's 3 years, something that had never happened before, of leadership solely from the range. So on the 4th, I will nominate Commissioner Boyle for vice chair. I would hope that one of those of you from the Iron Range will be the second. And I hope that does happen. So
have a second, Mr. or Commissioner Joel.
So obviously I didn't get that second. I didn't get that support last year. And I know that I'm unlikely to get it. So I'm not doing it for myself, but I am doing it so that Duluth does have that support. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Again, I would like to personally thank you for the work you've done during trying times, as Commissioner Nelson said. And it hasn't been easy. And I know I will be leaning on you for things as we move forward. In fact, that starts with our meeting on Friday. So thanks for all you've done. Appreciate the work and look forward to continuing the good relationship.
Thank you. I appreciate it. It has been an honor. Looking forward to, you know, handing it off. I know I like to make jokes, but I'm looking forward to handing it off, and we'll get this change coming around soon. For myself, I'd like to tell everybody, Merry Christmas, Happy New Year. Take extra time getting to where you're going. Everyone's in a hurry. Everyone's trying to get to someone's house for festivities. Take the extra time. We want to stay away from statistics, fatalities, accidents, whatever the case may be. We are all looking forward to spending time with people. Take an extra 10 minutes to get there. Slow down on the highway, whatever the case may be. And I have I've really been paying attention over this last couple of years and making these announcements for public safety. And I think for the most part, we've been doing a lot better with public safety. And of course, there's always instances where there's accidents and injuries. But I think, you know, if we all take just a few extra minutes and think about where we're going, how we're going to get there, and how much it means to everyone included to be there safely, it makes all the difference in the world. That being said, I'm going to avoid seeing all of you until at least next year.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Merry Christmas.
Thank you, everyone. Nita, you know, we have to close the committee.
Well, we got to go back to board again.
Yeah,
we
got to go back to
board. I would move the consent, Mr. Chair.
Okay, moved by Nelson. Second by Boyle. Discussion. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay, motion carries.
Move to adjourn.
Move to adjourn. Second by Commissioner Jewell. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Thank you. Motion carries. Marathon's done.
Thank you for reading.